The husband gets angry on the phone and goes, listen, you know what? You're divorced. Ooh. So the masjid has now become a place where you destroy people's families. There were aunties in the masjid, they were praying. A new woman came into the masjid, not seen before. She's new to the neighborhood. They asked her a question. They said, listen, where are you from? We haven't seen you around. She's like, I'm fresh. I just come from the country. Oh, they asked her questions. How do you live? Do you have children? Are you married? Where's your husband? Questions after questions. First of all, that's none of their business. It's got nothing to do with them. Everyone wants to know what this other person's personal life is. Honey, what's that got to do with you? من حسن الإسلام المرء تركوا ما لا يعني. One of the great qualities of a believer is that you do not concern yourself with that which doesn't concern you. So these sisters, they had bad maqsad, bad intent behind why they asked these questions. The sister told them, I've come here, I live here, my husband brought me, guess what? They said to her, where's your income? Where do you get money from? She said, my husband works. So they said to her, do you know that you're entitled to have money for your children? Oh, look at this. She said, no, I didn't know that. Yeah, the government gives you money. Even if your husband works, there's money that you're entitled to have for your children. They went as far as getting her to call her husband whilst in the masjid.
Sisters, what we heard just now was a true story of how some women destroyed an entire marriage because they got involved in things that was none of their business. As a result, they ruined a family, the masjid, and their own relationship with Allah, especially in the month of Ramadan. And perhaps the children of that family are still suffering to this day. We often focus on things that we should do in Ramadan, but very rarely do we focus on things that we shouldn't do in Ramadan. We put together a list of things that can help you earn the pleasure of Allah, especially in this blessed month of Ramadan. And by the way, for the brothers out there, after we filmed this video, we realized that these problems are not just for the sisters.
Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Lahul Hamdul Hassan wa Thana'ul Jameel, wa ashadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah, yaqulul haqqa wa huwa yahdi as-sabeel, wa ashadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa tabi'in lahum bi ihsanin ila yawmiddin amma ba'd. The first thing, my sisters, is which occurs very frequent, and I especially advise the sisters on this particular issue, is at-tahalli bil-akhlaq al-hasanat al-jabila. Sisters, adorn yourself with good characteristics and mannerism when you're in the masjid. There are people, different cultures and different ethnicities and different characters and different this. There are people who are old, senior in age. Have respect, come with respect when you come to the masjid. You're coming to the house of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. If you come to somebody else's house, you won't fight inside that person's house. Respect the house. The same way, and even more, you should respect the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then, definitely no vulgar language or shouting or screaming. That's not what the place is for. The salah is to prohibit you and to cleanse you from any deficiencies. And the masjid is meant to bring you back to a state of piety and nobility. Inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ مَا تَصْنَعُونَ Surah Al-Ankabut, Allah mentions that, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the salah, the purpose is to prohibit you and stop you from al-fahsha, vulgar and munkar and evil. وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ The remembrance of Allah is great. So you hear, remember Allah, engage in dhikr and adhkar. Sadly, wallahi, some sisters, they come to the masjid to backbite and to talk about other people's honor, other people's reputation, other people's livelihood, other people's life. Taqillah, you can't even do that outside. How are you going to come to the house of Allah and do that? Some people are gossiping about other people in the masjid, in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're talking about a sister who's come to the masjid, who's reverted, for example, and she's got tattoo, and now she's repented, and now she's pious, she's on the path of obeying her Lord and Allah. She might be higher in rank and position than this auntie who's been born Muslim all her life. But what's she doing? She's speaking about that sister's appearance, and she's talking about what she's got and how and etc. Or she's talking about another auntie in the masjid, and there's backbiting and all of that going on. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. A'udhu billah. The Prophet, look what he told us. Wallahi, sisters, look at the hadith in Adab al-Mufrad. Bukhari narrated in Adab al-Mufrad and Ahmad in his Musnad. Min hadith Abi Huraira. It was said to the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, inna fulana taqoomu al-layl. There's a woman, she prays qiyamu al-layl, wa tasoomu al-nahar, and she's fasting the whole day. Wa taf'alu wa tasaddaq. She goes and she does sadaqah, and this woman is righteous. But guess what? وَتُؤْذِي جِيرَانَهَا بِلِسَانِهَا. She harms her neighbor with her tongue. She's, her tongue is open. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The Prophet, he said, لَا خَيْرَ فِيهَا هِيَ مِنْ أَهْلِ النَّارِ. This woman, there's no khair in her. Fonda here. لَا خَيْرَ فِيهَا. They said, إِنَّ فُلَانَ تَقُومُ اللَّيْلِ. She stands up at night. وَتَصُومُ النَّهَارِ وَتَفْعَلُ وَتَصَدَّقُ. She gives sadaqah, she does, she does. The Prophet, he said, لا خير فيها هي من أهل النار. This woman, there's no khair in her. She's from the women of the people of the hellfire. Then they told her another woman. وفلانة تصلي المكتوبة. This woman, she only prays obligatory prayer. وتصدق يعني, she gives out يعني بأتوار يعني من الأقط. She gives dry yogurt or whatever, things like that. ولا تؤذي أحدا. She doesn't harm anybody. She gives very basic stuff. She only prays her five daily prayers. No قيام الليل, nothing like that. فقال رسول الله, the Prophet, he said, هي من أهل الجنة. This woman is from the people of Jannah. So sister, sitting in the masjid, talking about this sister, talking about that sister, talking about that brother, talking about that man's honor. This your tongue. احفظ لسانك أيها الإنسان لا يلدغنك إنه ثعبان. كم في المقابر من قتيل لسانه كان تهاب لقاه شجعا. Protect your tongue, wallahi. احفظ لسانك أيها الإنسان لا يلدغنك إنه ثعبان. Do not let your tongue bite you. It's a scorpion. It's a snake. It's going to eat you. Your tongue is dangerous. How many people, the poet said, have ended up in their graves, were killed, يعني were destroyed only because of words that they uttered. Words that they said. So sister, you're coming to the house of Allah and you're sitting at the back and you're gossiping about Fulana has gained weight. What has she been doing? That woman, her husband divorced her. That woman, her husband have this issue. The masjid has now become a place of gossip. Ittaqillah. Fear Allah. And some people do it في شهر رمضان. And wallah, I've told this story before. قسم لمن أحل القسم. I swear by the Lord who permitted swearing by him. I remember a story of an auntie that came to the masjid. This is a true story. The woman who did it, I heard it from her own ears. She's a family auntie. She went to the masjid. Listen to the story. And they were praying Salat, Ramadan, Taraweeh, Qiyamul Layl. People are praying, indulged in ibadah and reciting Qur'an and adhkar, and etc. There were aunties in the masjid, they were praying. A new woman came into the masjid, not seen before. She's new to the neighborhood. No one's seen her before. They asked her questions. They interrogated her because they know each other. They've seen each other in the masjid, but they haven't seen her. They asked her a question. They said, listen, where are you from? We haven't seen you around. She's like, I'm fresh. I just come from the country. I've not been in the country for too long. Oh, Mash, where do you live? I don't know the area very well. But she described it and they finally came to know where she lives. Okay. Interrogating her now. Look, she's new. She's new to the country. She's come to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Guess what? They asked her questions. They say, how do you live? Do you have children? Are you married? Where's your husband? Questions after questions. First of all, that's none of their business. It's got nothing to do with them. Asking people's personal lives. And this is another issue that we have. Everyone wants to know what this other person's personal life is. Honey, what's that got to do with you? من حسن الإسلام المرء تركوا ما لا يعني. One of the great qualities of a believer is that you do not concern yourself with that which doesn't concern you. Wallahi, I should have brought some of those quotes from the Salaf. But some of the A'immatu Salaf, they never used to ask other people other than, يعني, I think Muhammad ibn Sirin and others, it was mentioned from them, that all they would say to somebody is, كيف حالك? And they wouldn't say anything more than that. السلام عليكم كيف حالك? And that's it. They wouldn't ask about his children and go into his personal life. And the reason to that is, Ibn Abi Dunya mentions in his Mawsu'ah, I read it from there. But I don't know which one in his Mawsu'ah he mentioned it in. Anyways, they never used to indulge and ask about and يعني, involve themselves in things that didn't concern them. So these sisters asking questions, interrogating her, wanting to know these things with لَا شَكَ وَلَا رَيْبٍ, from what you're going to know in the story, they had bad maqsad, bad intent behind why they asked these questions. The sister told them, I've come here, I live here, my husband brought me, and etc. They said to her, where's your income? Where do you get money from? She said, my husband works. What about your children? I think she mentioned a good number of children that she had, a five or something. I don't remember the figure, but it was a good number of children. They said to her, but you're entitled. Oh, look at this. So the masjid has now become a place where you destroy people's families. So they said to her, do you know that you're entitled to have money for your children? She said, no, I didn't know that. Yeah, the government gives you money. Even if your husband works, he's full-time working. There's money that you're entitled to have for your children. This is something that the government permits for you. Ajib. See, they're now. Sister, no, I didn't know that. No, my husband gives us everything. No, sister, these are things that you should have. It's your haqq. You need to grow up, take experience from us. We came to this country. You can't attach yourself to your husband and this and that. Mushkila. They went as far as getting her to call her husband whilst in the masjid and saying, ask him, find out right now. Yeah, you can. So she calls her husband. Maybe most likely he didn't have a good day that day. He was frustrated, upset, angry. And she called him and she said, is it true that you take this money? Why haven't you told me? Why am I hearing it now for the first time? And etc. He said, do I not provide for you? What does it matter? Who? I'm the Rabbul Bayt, etc. I'm not judging what he did. Is it right? Is it wrong? That's another discussion. What I believe about that. But the point here right now is, and the focus point here in the story is, this sister is now interrogating her husband. Why? Because of what these other sisters have told her in the masjid, the house of Allah. The husband gets angry on the phone and goes, listen, you know what? You're divorced. Ooh. She puts the phone down. She's in a state of shock. She doesn't know where to start from. And guess what, my brothers and sisters? They've led that sister to leave the country by her husband. Because remember, he brought her into the country. The paperwork haven't been finalized. He ended the entire marriage and he sent her back. And said, khalas. Those kids, their mother. He said, if you're saying this to me now and you've not even been here for a while, what are you going to do a few years into this marriage and a few years living in this country? You're just going to give me a headache. Go back to the country. Again, what he did, what is he doing? It's not I'm not talking about judging between the two of them now. But I just want to show you the masjid, the women in the masjid, to get involved in that type of situation and that type of family issues. What has it got to do with you? What does that have anything to do with you, sister? Whether he's right or wrong, whether he's a good husband or not, leave that to the people of knowledge. Leave that to the wise people of the tribe or the family or the relative to deal with this issue. But as a sister, to be the cause of destroying someone's marriage in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that says a lot about you. That says a lot about you. And I'm telling you, sisters, wallahi, my sisters, especially the Westerners, sisters, wallahi, fear Allah in what you say about people. Wallahi, protect your tongues. You're throwing allegations and accusations biduni dalilin wala burhan. It's all based on speculation. Fulan said this, but so-and-so said this, and you're gossiping. Wallahi, you're going to stand in front of Allah yawm al-qiyamah, and you're naked, uncircumcised. You're going to be shoeless. You're going to be standing in front of Allah, and you're going to be judged. And every good deed that you have done and you've put together will be taken by that person. So now think about it. Think wisely. Do you want your good deeds being taken by someone? And if your good deeds finish, you start taking the sins and the mistakes and the wrongdoings of somebody else. Think wisely about it. Fear Allah in what you say and you do in the house of Allah and who you talk about. And by the way, generally, protect your tongue. Let alone what the sisters are doing on social media, talking about this person and talking about that person and talking about this imam and talking about that person or that sheikh or that talib or that other sister in the masjid. Yani sisters have complained that other sisters are the reason why they don't come to the masjid. In the West, if a sister or a brother is not connected to the masjid, as the Prophet, he said in the hadith, it reminds me of that hadith, which is inna dhi'ba ya'kulu al-ghanam al-ghashi, that the wolf will eat the goat that's by itself.
If you're not in the Muslim community, you're not in the masjid, and you stay away from the masjid in the Western countries, your iman will just go down like a thermometer. Huh? The percentage will just go down until you find yourself يعني, questioning Islam and whether this religion is for you. Trust me. And one of the ways to protect your deen in those countries that you guys have chosen to live in is to be in the masajid. Rijalun wa nisa'a, men or women. I say that even for the sisters. Because a lot of them in their households don't have a structure of Islam. If that sister is connected to the masjid because of lessons, and she's connected to that lesson for khair and good, and you become a mu'awwiq, an obstacle to prevent her from coming to the masjid because of your gossips and your shaming and your name calling, what are you going to say to Allah yawm al-qiyamah? Are you not scared that you might enter the verse of Allah, وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ مَنَعَ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ أَنْ يُذْكَرَ فِيهَا اسْمُهُ. Maybe, I'm not saying that you are, but maybe that you might enter those people who are preventing the people of remembering Allah in His house by your gossips and by causing sisters to leave. And the brothers have their portion, wallahi. Oh yes, they do. Brothers are preventing other brothers from coming to the masjid only because of how they shame them and etc. Taqillah. Another mistake that happens is the free mixing that happens after the salah. When the salah is over and the people have prayed, sisters, instead of getting out of the masjid and leaving before the brothers come down. And then brothers side, there should be a protocol inside the masjid where the brothers are told to stay for a little bit. Women are given time to leave the masjid as the sunnah of the Prophet is. The women go, and then maybe 5, 10, 15 minutes later, the brothers go out. No, what sisters do is, they stay in the parking lot. They stand around. Yeah, they stand around. And the brothers come out, and then guess what happens? There's ikhtilat, bil-rijal. Men and women are now actually literally physically mixing, close proximity. The brother is seeing the sister. And subhanAllah, I have to say this, I'm sorry, but some sisters actually come with the intention of meeting a potential brother. And some brothers, they come for that opportunity. They say, this masjid is very good, I like it. Why do you like it? Because there's sisters he wants to meet in the parking lot. So his hadaf and his ghaya is, this is haqiqah, my brothers and sisters. And it's things, and over the years, we used to see and concern and issues used to come from it. So the brother's coming to the masjid to meet those sisters. The sister is also standing outside and she's waiting, sitting around or standing around. Maybe that brother might somehow see her or talk to her. And this is wrong. The Prophet ﷺ was very, very careful when it came to men and women mixing, like standing right, literally mixing. That's what happens in a lot of the masajids. The women and the men are actually mixing, sometimes inside the masjid. And Imam Abu Dawood narrated, and other than him, من حديث ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال that the Prophet, he said, لو تركنا هذا الباب للنساء, if we leave this door for the women, the Prophet saying this. And he just suggested it, if we left that door for the, because there was one door, the brothers and the women, the Prophet's message was simple. The Prophet said, if only we leave this masjid, this door for the women, and another door was suggested for the men. Nafi' then said, فَلَمْ يَدْخُلْ مِنْهُ بْنُ عُمَرَ حَتَّى مَاتْ. Abdullah ibn Umar never entered from that door ever again. What's the illah to make a door specific for the women? Why? مَنْعُ اِخْتِلَاطِهِنَّ بِالرِّجَالِ وَمَا يَتَرَتَّبُ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْفِتْنَةِ. To prevent the men and women mixing, and the fitna that comes from this. And subhanAllah, nowadays, especially, I have to, again, I'm sorry, today I am saying يعني, places and I'm a bit harsher in this, but I hope people are not offended and I hope people can be, يعني, just look at the content and what I'm trying to say. I have no bad intention for anybody, wallahi. إن أريد إلا الإصلاح ما استطعت. I intend good, inshaAllah ta'ala. But subhanAllah, from what we see that comes from America, the North America, the things that we see, where some Islamic organizations are encouraging in their lessons and in the durus that they're giving for boys and the girls to be sitting right next to each other. And some of that is even being done in the masjid under the banner of Women and sisters and brothers have to be given the fair rights of studying and learning. Kayf. Look, you're not more caring and more concerned about Allah and His Messenger. Why is the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam restricting a particular door for the sisters and say this door for the women? The illah, the reason for that is man'u ikhtilatihinna bil-rijali wa ma yatarattabu alayhi min al-fitnah. ولذلك, if you look at the kitab Aun al-Ma'bud, in the sharh of the hadith, he said, بَابُ اعْتِزَالِ النِّسَاءِ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ عَنِ الرِّجَالِ لَوْ تَرَكْنَا هَذَا الْبَابِ. He said, أي باب المسجد الذي أشار إليه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم النساء لَكَانَ خَيْرًا وَأَحْسَن لِأَلَّا. Listen to this. So there is not what? لِأَلَّا تَخْتَلِدَ النِّسَاءُ بِالرِّجَالِ فِي الدُّخُولِ وَالْخُرُوجِ مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ. When they're entering the masjid and coming out. وَالْحَدِيثُ فِيهِ دَلِيلُ عَلَى أَنَّ النِّسَاءَ لَا يَخْتَلِطْنَ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ مَعَ الرِّجَالِ بَلْ يَعْتَزِلْنَ فِي جَانِبِ الْمَسْجِدِ. The women should be separate from the men. Over there, they have their own يعني, area. They have their own exit door. They pray behind the imam and they go. And I'm going to be honest, within our culture, especially my culture, the Somali community, they're very relaxed with this issue of free mixing. Especially if you go to the Somali masajids, if we could say Somali masajid, لأن المساجد لله, the masajids are not meant to be owned by communities. It's actually only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everyone has that masjid. It's everyone's masjid. But you find those masajid that are run by Somali community, you find that the free mixing a lot of the times is very high. Wherever you go, you'll find it. They're very easy with the idea. Even in the, within the Somali household, this is a very common behavior. The issue of the opposite gender, uncle, wa'adherka, wa'ruwa abtiga. You know, he's your uncle, he's your aunt, and everyone's sitting together. And free mixing is taken very lightly. Things like that should be avoided and should be stayed away from. Okay? Staying away from all of that because of the effects and the severity that come from it. Another mistake I find that takes place in the masajid is people don't have the soft side. يعني لين الجانب, gentleness. When you come into the masjid, it's not like work. This is... by the way, my audience, a lot of you guys are Westerners. I find this more common in the West. Yes, finance and people are frustrated and they're angry and everything. Yes, that is the case. Recently, my trip to the UK recently, the minute I landed in Heathrow Airport, till the moment I went to my destination, whatever shop I went to, the queues were long. People were shouting at each other. I did not go to a place, even the airport that I went to, the entirety was just a mess. So this does affect people's character. It affects people. If you're every day going to work and you're being this and you're being this and people are doing this to you and they're saying this to you and it's about كُلْ ذِئْبًا لَا يَأْكُلُكَ الذِّئَا, be a wolf so the wolves don't eat you. That's the kind of life that you're living at work. When you come to the masjid, you're on the edge. So then you are... you lose the touch, you lose gentleness and softness. And you need to remember, these people that you're praying next to is Muslims. It's not the Steve and Michael and James and Ben that you're working with in work, or Steve, Stephanie or Charlotte, or these women that you're working with, sister. These are Muslims. This is Ahmed, Khalid, Zayd, Bakr, Amr. So what do you have to observe? Lean al-Jalib. These are your brothers. Be gentle, be soft. Endure things from them. Smile. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةَ. Most of the believers are what? Brothers. The Prophet told us about the description of the believers. أَذِلَّةٍ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَعِزَّةٍ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. The characteristic of a believer is he's soft for the believers. Gentle. In the masjid when I come, I'll tolerate Allah. Maybe at work, I'll get my rights. I'll write my complaint letters and I would take this to the high levels. No problem. Do that in work. That's fine. You should do that. Get your rights at work. Like when you come to the masjid, that's your brother. Akhi, that's your sister. And be gentle. Look what the Prophet told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, in the hadith of Imam Ahmad and Tirmidhi and others narrated, Shaykh al-Bani rahimahullah authenticated it. Min hadith Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, ala ukhbirukum ala man tahrumun nar. Shall I tell you a person who the nar is haram from? Meaning he won't enter the hellfire. Who is it? على كل هين لين سهل قريب. الله أكبر. The person who the hellfire is haram from is a person who has these qualities. على كل هين لين سهلٍ قريبٍ. Gentle, soft, easygoing, close. You want to get his, it's so easy. There are some people, complicated. You start something, okay, sorry, I'm sorry. I'll leave you. Barakallahu fi. It's an argument, it's a debate, it's a mushkila. That's not a sifa min sifatil mu'mineen, from the characteristics of the believers. The believer is known to be hayyin, layyin, sahal qarib. People want to deal with you, they want to ask you a question, they want to bring something to your attention, they've done a mistake in your presence, you want to correct it or they want you to correct it for them. You're soft, you're easygoing. Anyone whose characteristics is not that way, that's not praiseworthy. They're halat nadira, rare situations where of course it's required for a person to be tough and a bit strong. But the general habit and the general culture and the demeanor of a person is what? Hayyin, layyin, sahl, qareeb. That's the quality that you should have. Another mistake that happens, some of the sisters, they leave with abayas that they wear. And on those abaya, there are yani beauty, glitters and yani. So they wear beautiful abaya, sometimes even the color of some of the abayas. And some of the abayas, what it's made from is silky and etc., which is a form of beauty. The sister, the hijab that should have been the things to yani turn the men's eyes away from her, yani in order to cover her, she's using that hijab or that abaya to attract the opposite gender. And where is she going to? She's going to the masjid. Now, this is something that a sister should avoid. When you're going, sisters, to the masjid, you should not wear clothing which is beautified. Sisters are not meant to wear that. Wear clothing which is decent, which meets the condition of a hijab. Like in anything that's beautiful, you beautified it in order to catch the attention of the opposite gender. This is something that the Sharia doesn't allow. وَلِذَلِكَ the women at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, they used to come to the Salatul Fajr. And they used to come mutalafi'atin bimurutihinna. They would come covering their faces. Okay? Covering their body. They would wrap themselves around properly. They would cover their faces. They would cover their entire body. مَا يُعْرَفُ أَحَدٌ لَا يَعْرِفُهُنَّ أَحَدٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ مَا يَعْرِفُهُنَّ أَحَدٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ. No one would recognize them. That's how the wives and the women of the time of the Prophet were like. When they would go to the masjid, they would wrap themselves up, they would cover their entire body, that nobody would recognize them. It actually was transmitted authentically in Sahih Muslim that Amra binti Abdulrahman, she said, سَمِعْتُ I heard Aisha, زَوْجَ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ تَقُولُ I heard the wife of the Prophet صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ saying, لو أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عائشة say this. I want you sisters to internalize this. This is a very important message. عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها, the wife of the Prophet, is saying this. لو أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رأى ما حدثت النساء أما ما أحدث النساء لو أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رأى ما أحدث النساء. If the Prophet was to see what the women introduced, yani what the women started, Aisha saying this, if radiallahu ta'ala anha, if the Prophet saw what the women have done when they go to the masjid and the way that they dress when they leave, what would he have done? La mana'ahunna al-masjida, he would have prohibited them from going to the masjid. Kama muni'at nisa'u bani Israila, just the same way the women of Bani Israel were prohibited from going to the masajids when they started to dress a certain way. Then it was said to Amra bint Abdulrahman, فَقِيلَ لِعَمْرَ أَنِسَاءُ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ مُنِعْنَا الْمَسْجِدَ قَالَتْ نَحَمْ. When the women of Bani Israel are prohibited from the masjid, That question was posed to Amrah binti Abdulrahman, the woman who was narrating from Aisha. She said, yes, of course. So I want you sisters to listen to this. If our mother Aisha say at her time that the women introduced, they started to dress a certain way, and if the Prophet was to see them, he would have prohibited them from going to the masjid. Then my question to you is, فَإِذَا لَوْ رَأَتْ حَالُنَا الْيَوْمِ. What about if Aisha was to see our situation today? Allah al-Musta'an. Also, one of the common mistakes that with some sisters when they go to the masjid is كَثْرَةُ الْحَدِيثِ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ قَبْلَ الصَّلَاةِ. The sister's side is always a complaint that comes from it when it comes to talking. Women come to the masjid sometimes to socialize. They left home, they came to the masjid and they're socializing, they're talking before the prayer, sometimes even while the Taraweeh is going on. Sometimes they are chatting and they're raising their voice so much so that in some of the masajid, you can hear the women talking from the men's side. And this is a complaint that comes very frequent. If you've been an imam of a masjid, you will know this, that the women complain that there are other women that are chatting in the masjid. Sometimes there's durus going on, lessons going on. And there are some women who come and they chat in the masjid while there's a lesson going on. And there's another group of people who want to study, want to learn. So, kathratul hadithi fil masjidi, this is something sisters should avoid. The masjid was not built for conversations and talking and so buying and talking about worldly issues. Allah says in the Qur'an, فِي بُيُوتٍ أَذِنَ اللَّهُ أَن تُرُفَعَ وَيُذْكَرَ فِي هَسْمُ يُسَبِّحُ لَهُ فِيهَا بِالْغُدُوِّ وَالْآصَالِ رِجَالٌ لَا تُلْهِيهِمْ تِجَارَةٌ وَلَا بَيْعٌ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَإِقَامِ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِيتَاءِ الزَّكَاةِ يَخَافُونَ يَوْمًا تَتَقَلَّبُ فِيهِ الْقُلُوبُ وَالْأَبْصَارُ. Allah mentions this in Surah An-Nur. Allah mentions in this verse, okay, that the masajids, fi buyutin, according to Ibn Abbas and Mujahid and Hassan al-Basri, the word buyut as mentioned in this verse is referring to the masajid. That's what Abdullah ibn Abbas said, Mujahid said, Hassan al-Basri, radiyallahu ta'ala wa rahimahumullah. That's what they said. So when they come to the masjid, what do? لا تلهيهم تجارة. Do not be a person who is distracted with trading and business. ولا بيع عن ذكر الله. And the remembrance of Allah. Ha, don't be talking about worldly issues and business and how much you're paying rent in your house in the masajid, when the masajid are built for remembrance of Allah and iqam al-salah and etc. That's what you should be engaged in. Allah even told us, subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to the people's speech and their discussions, majority of them, what did Allah say? He said, لا خير في كثير من نجواهم إلا من أمر بصدقة أو معروف أو إصلاح بين الناس ومن يفعل ذلك ابتغاء مرضات الله فسوف نؤتيه أجرا عظيما. Allah says many of the people's discussions and dialogues that they have, my brothers and sisters, many of it, لا خير في كثير من نجواهم. Many of their discussions, there is no خير in it. A lot of times if you sit in gatherings, you will realize a lot of the people's discussions and dialogues and the conversations that they're having between themselves, لا خير في كثير من نجواهم. Allah then says, إلا except those conversations where it's what? إلا من أمر بصدقة. Somebody is commanding you to give sadaqah. أو معروف. Or that person is telling you to do something good. يعني يدعوك إلى المعروف. He's calling you towards good. أو إصلاح بين الناس. Or he's working towards bringing the Muslims together. He's talking because he's doing إصلاح بين الناس. ومن يفعل ذلك. And anyone who does any of those good deeds, they do it what? ابْتِغَاءَ مَرْضَاتِ اللَّهِ, seeking Allah's face subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَسَوْفَ نُؤْتِي أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. Allah is going to give you a lot of reward. What's actually really shocking is that Abdul Razzaq ibn Hammam al-San'ani narrated in his Musannaf from Ibn Muhayrizin rahimahullah ta'ala that he said, الْكَلَامُ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ لَغْوٌ. The general qa'ida is what? Speech in the masjid is idle speech. لَغْوٌ. No value. إِلَّا لِمُصَلِّنْ أَوْ ذَاكِرٍ رَبَّهُ أَوْ ذَاكِرٍ أَوْ ذَاكِرِ رَبِّهِ أَوْ سَائِرِ خَيْرٍ أَوْ مُعْطِيهِ أَوْ سَائِرِ خَيْرٍ أَوْ مُعْطِيهِ. Al-Kalamu fil Masjid is lagwun. Speech in the Masjid is idle speech. That's a general principle. And there's exceptions. Except the person who's praying, a person who's remembering his Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reminding the people of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, or a person who's asking people good, or is giving the people good. Those are the situations where talking and even opening your mouth to say anything in the Masjid is good. Other than that, it's low. So sisters, do not come to the Masjid to chit-chat and to talk. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ankara ala ba'di as-sahaba, the Prophet rejected the action of some of the companions when he saw them raising their voices in the Masjid, in reading Qur'an. Imagine that, reading Qur'an, they raised their voice. The Prophet, he didn't accept that from them. Why? What's the reason? فَيُشَوِّشُونَ عَلَى بَعْضِهِمِ الْبَعْضِ. Because what's going to happen? Some of them are going to, somebody's praying, you're reading Qur'an loud, you're going to stop that person from praying the salah properly. You're going to affect their khushu'. Another person over there wants to read their Qur'an, you're affecting that person. So if you can't raise your voice in reading the Qur'an in the masjid, then what do you think if you're speaking about worldly issues and you're raising your voice and you're causing the people, you're affecting the people's Qur'an and their recitation of the Qur'an and also their prayer and their remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet even referred to them raising their, listen, I want you sisters to focus on this, them raising their voices in reciting the Qur'an, the Prophet referred to it as an adhiyya, harm. Abi Sa'id al-Khudri narrated this. He said, i'takafa Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fil masjid. The Prophet did i'tikaf in the masjid. فَسَمِعَهُمْ يَجْهَرُونَ بِالْقِرَاءَةِ وَهُوَ فِي قُبَّةٍ لَهُ. The Prophet ﷺ heard them reciting the Qur'an, and the Prophet ﷺ had a little qubba that was built for him, that it was inside. فَكَشَفَ السُّتُورَ. The Prophet moved the veil. وَقَالَ, he then said, أَلَا إِنَّ كُلَّكُمْ مُنَاجِ رَبَّهُ فَلَا يُؤْذِيَنَّ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا وَلَا يَرْفَعَنَّ بَعْضُكُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ بِالْقِرَاءَةِ أو قال في الصلاة رواه أحمد وأبو داود. The Prophet, he said, every one of you here is calling onto his Lord. The one who's praying is calling onto Allah. The one who's reciting Quran is calling onto Allah. The one who's in that, يعني, doing his dhikr, he's calling onto Allah. Everyone here is for what? Why are they there? To call onto their Lord, Allah, to talk to their Lord, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. So what should we do? فَلَا يُؤْذِيَنَّ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا. The hadith is saying, do not harm one another. وَلَا يَرْفَعَنَّ بَعْضُكُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ مِنْ قِرَاءٍ. Don't raise your voice so much so that you're harming the people next to you. Don't. أو في الصلاة. My sisters, if this is the Qur'an and the recitation of the Qur'an, then what do you think about speech? This is min babi awla. Sisters are raising their voices in the masjid whilst the imam is actually in the salah reading Surah Al-Fatiha. And it's an obligatory prayer. Some sisters are still talking before they say Allahu Akbar. And this causes tashwish on the people that are there. So this is something to be very careful of, my sisters, and not to do this to the people. And as Ramadan is coming, you want to reap reward and ajr. Another mistake that some of us sisters fall into is there are some sisters who place on their heads khimar, but their hair is showing. She doesn't cover her hair completely. When she's praying, before the prayer, coming to the masjid, her khimar is back, and you can see the first part of her hair and her head can be seen. She doesn't even, her neck can be seen, some of them. So some of her, and she might even pray in that state. Okay? Sister, if you pray like that, your salah will be nullified if you did it deliberately. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَا تُقْبَلُ صَلَاتُ الْحَائِضِ إِلَّا بِخِمَارِ. That a woman who has reached puberty, her salah is not accepted unless she prays with a khimar. What does it mean, the word al-ha'id? It means al-mar'atu al-baliq, the woman who reaches puberty. Okay? Her salah is not accepted illa bi khimar. What does it mean illa bi khimar? The word khimar is بكسر الخاء. What does it mean? It means هو ما يغطي به رأس البرأة. It's what covers the woman's head. Okay? And the hadith I'm using here is being used as what? That the woman has to cover her hair when she's praying the salah. ولذلك أبو عيسى التلميذي رحمه الله, the great scholar, what did he say? He said حديث عائشة is a حديث حسن والعمل عليه عند أهل العلم. This hadith is a hadith which is hasan. It's a hadith that the people of knowledge acted upon. أن المرأة إذا أدركت, that if the woman reaches puberty, فصلت وشيء من فصلت, she prays. A woman prays. وشيء من شعرها مكشوف, and some of her hair is showing. لا تجوز صلاتها, so her prayer is not corrected nor is it accepted. وهو قول الشافعي, and this is the قول of an Imam الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى. So if a sister deliberately, she's lackadaisical, she's careless, she goes to the masjid, she places the khibar on her head, but she doesn't fully cover her head, and so her hair is showing, her salah is not valid, and it will not be accepted. Some sisters, what they do is they leave their houses with perfumes on, and they go into Taraweeh in Ramadan. They want to pray in Taraweeh, and they have on themselves perfume that they've put on themselves. And this, my brothers and sisters, is not permissible for a Muslim believing sister to place on herself perfume when she leaves the house. Whether it be for the salah or whether it be for anything else, a sister should not be placing perfume on herself when leaving the house. Zainab al-Thaqafiyya, radiyallahu anha, she said, كانت تحدث عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال إذا شهدت أما إذا شهدت إحداكن العشاء فلا تطيب تلك الليلة. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said in this hadith, if one of you sisters, any woman, wants to participate in the Isha congregation, she wants to come for the Isha prayer in the masjid, the sister wants to come, إِذَا شَهِدَتْ إِحْدَى كُنَّ الْعِشَاءَ, one of you wants to come and participate in the Isha congregation, the narration says فَلَا تَطَيَّبْ تِلْكَ اللَّيْلَ, do not place perfume on yourself that night. Another wording, it mentions إِذَا شَهِدَتْ إِحْدَى كُنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ فَلَا تَمَسَّ طِيبًا. The first narration restricts it to the Isha prayer. But the next wording, it says, if one of you women want to come to the masjid, فَلَا تَمَسَّ طِيبًا, do not touch, do not place on yourself perfume. Both of those wordings, Al-Imam Muslim narrated it in his Sahih. So focus with me, sisters, here. You're coming to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want to pray in the congregation. You're not allowed in no way, shape or form to place on yourself anything. Call it what you like that makes you smell nice. So if it's a perfume that makes you smell nice, you're not allowed to. And it's a perfume, you're not allowed to place it on yourself. Or a woman puts bukhur. The Arabs, they have a culture where they put bukhur on something and then it gives a good smell. If it's going to make you smell nice and it's going to attract the opposite gender, it's not allowed. Okay? What about if it's a deodorant and it has a perfume smell to it? Okay? It's got that smell to it. And the Sharia connected the prohibition to whatever makes the woman smell nice. Now there's a difference here. I want you guys to understand. I'm not saying a sister can't wear a deodorant, as I do not see it that the deodorant can be considered as a perfume. But I'm giving a scenario where if it was the case that there was a deodorant where if the sister puts it on, it's going to smell all day like a perfume, then shara'an this is not permissible. فَلَا تَمَسَّ طِيبًا, because it's what? It's a perfume. But that doesn't mean, and I'm going to speak about it later, that she can't smell good. There's a difference between smelling good and there's a difference between smelling with perfume. Smelling good is that you have your clean and your cleanliness that we're going to talk about, inshallah ta'ala. Al-Imam Abu Dawood and Ahmed narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on the authority of Abu Hurairah, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke to the men. The Prophet, he said, لا تمنعوا إماء الله مساجد الله. The Prophet is talking to the men. He's saying to the men, do not prohibit the women from going to the masjid. So no husband can stop his wife from going to Taraweeh. If she wants to go to Taraweeh, he can't stop her. لا تمنعوا إماء الله مساجد الله. If the woman wants to go and pray the Taraweeh, she wants to pray the Isha, you cannot prevent her. Then look what the Prophet then said. ولكن ليخرجنا وهن تفلات. What does that mean? ولكن but ليخرجنا, the women should leave. وهن تفلات. What does it mean, تفلات? It means غير متطيبات. The women should leave, لكن, without placing perfume on themselves. So all you men, you cannot stop your wives from going to the masjid. Don't stop them from going to the masjid. But sisters, the hadith is saying, do not place perfume on yourselves when you go. So this is addressing the men and the women simultaneously. We men are not allowed to, and the women are not allowed to do that. The men are not allowed to prohibit their women from going to the masjid. They're not allowed to stop them from going to the masajid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the women are not allowed to place perfume on themselves. So we all have to follow the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His messenger. We have no choice here. But the second point I want to talk about, which is the opposite of what I mentioned there. Some sisters don't clean themselves, or they don't clean their garments. So there's no nadafa, cleanliness on the body and also the clothing. And do you know where this comes from sometimes? It comes from her just having cooked and yani made the iftar. She made everything ready for the people and she rushes to go to Taraweeh. And she hasn't done nadafa, cleanliness of her body. She hasn't showered. She hasn't cleaned herself. And her clothes, sometimes it smells from the, you know, ra'ihatu ta'am, the smell of the food. Okay? And she didn't get rid of that. And how can she get rid of that? By wearing a new set of clothing that doesn't have the smell of food. Sometimes a sister might leave the house and she's eaten basal. Basal meaning onion or garlic or something like that. Mimma yu'dhi al-hadirati fil masajid. That which will then harm the sisters who are praying around next to her. So this is also not allowed. So don't go to extremes. Don't place perfume on yourselves to cover that smell. Okay? And also don't be, be in a state where you're not hygienic and you're not clean. The Prophet prohibited, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, not for only the sisters, but the brothers as well. Leaving after, for example, brothers do this as well. They had a football game, they were playing football, or they were playing basketball, whatever they were playing a sport, and they're sweating. And they go to the masjid. Akhi, stop the football game early, go and shower, and then go to the masjid and pray. Or sometimes the person will have onion, garlic, and people tend to have a lot of food when they're fasting in Ramadan after iftar. So when they are in Taraweeh, a lot of the brothers are burping and the sisters the same. And so what happens, this causes the people around you to smell what's coming from your mouth. So brush your teeth. Brush your teeth. Even have a chewing gum before you leave, so that your mouth is not only clean, but it's also, mashallah, good smell. The Prophet, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من أكل من هذه الشجرة المنتنة. Anyone who eats from this filthy tree, فَلَا يَقْرَبَنَّ مَسْجِدَنَا. They should not come close to our masjid. فَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَةَ تَتَأَذَّى مِمَّا يَتَأَذَّى مِنْهُ الْإِنسُ. that the angels, they get harm from whatever harms the human beings. Yani the humans don't like that smell, right? That bad smell when somebody just had onion or garlic. So do the angels. The angels don't like it as well. And Imam Muslim narrated this in his Sahih, min hadithi Jabir ibn Abdullah radiyallahu anhuma. So sisters, after having cooked and cleaned the house, inshallah ta'ala, don't forget to shower, clean yourself before you go to the masjid. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said in the hadith that al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated in the Sahih, in hadith Aisha radiyallahu ta'ala anha, كَانَ النَّاسُ يَنْتَابُونَ يَوْمَ الْجُمُعَةِ مِنْ مَنَازِلِهِمْ وَالْعَوَالِي فَيَأْتُونَ فِي الْغُبَارِ يُصِيبُهُمُ الْغُبَارِ وَالْعَرَقِ فَيَخْرُجُ مِنْهُمُ الْعَرَقِ فَأَتَى رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِنْسٌ مِنْهُمْ وَهُوَ عِنْدِي فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لَوْ أَنَّكُمْ تَطَهَّرْتُمْ لِيَوْمِكُمْ هَذَا. The Prophet, he said, on the hadith of Aisha radiyallahu ta'ala anha, she said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at his time, some of the people come to the Jumu'ah, and of course when they're coming, dust, they would sweat, yani, and they wouldn't be at the best state possible. This is on a Friday, Jumu'ah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would say, لَوْ أَنَّكُمْ تَطَهَّرْتُمْ لِيَوْمِكُمْ هَذَا. If only you cleaned yourself for this day. If only. So don't be of any of those two extremes. Oh sisters, don't go extreme in placing perfume on yourself. And also don't go extreme in coming out of your houses when you sweated and you are not in the, you're not clean, you're not, yani, the tahara is not there. Another mistake that occurs is some sisters, what they do is they raise their voice when they're reading Surah Al-Fatiha, or when they're doing the tasbih in the ruku', okay, or the sujood, or other places in the salah, their voices are very loud. When they're doing their Fatiha, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alamin, Ar-Rahman, it's like they're the imam now, everyone can hear them. Or when they're in their sujood or their ruku', Subhana Rabbil Azim, Subhana Rabbil Azim, the person next to you can't even do their one. Your tashwish ala al-musallina fil masjid. So this again, لا يجوز لك رفع الصوت بقراءة القرآن قبل إقامة الصلاة. Okay? Imam Ahmad narrated in hadith Abdullah ibn Umar, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خرج على الناس وهم يصلون وقد علت أصواته بالقراءة فقال إن المصلي يناجي ربه عز وجل فلينظر بما يناجيه ولا يجهر. He says, بعضكم على بعض بالقرآن. Prohibited it. Don't raise your voices over each other when it comes to reading the Quran. We talked about that before. Okay? Hadith Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, Abu Dawood, al-Nasa'i and others narrated, اعتكف في المسجد فسمعهم يجهرون بالقراءة فكشف الستر. The Prophet was doing itikaf in the masjid and he heard the people raising their voices. So he opened the curtain and he said to them, ألا إن كلكم مناجي ربه. Every one of you is calling unto his Lord. So فلا يؤذين بعضكم بعضا. Don't harm each other. ولا يرفع بعضكم على بعض بالقراءة. Don't harm each other and raise your voices over each other when reading the Quran. Another mistake that happens that I want to talk about today is تركوا ستر القدمين في الصلاة. A lot of sisters, they leave off covering their foot or their feet. They don't cover it in the salah. And this is obligatory upon the woman, على الصحيح, according to the strongest opinion, and تستر قدميها, that she covers her feet in the prayer. And the majority of the ulama, they use as an evidence that show is obligatory, hadith Abi Dawud narrated, and hadith Umm Salama, radiyallahu ta'ala anha, annaha sa'alati an-nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she asked the Prophet, atusalli al-mar'a, does the woman pray fi dir'in wa khimar? Does the woman pray in a dir'a, which is a long garment? and a khimar, which covers the head. Laysa alayha izarun, where she doesn't have an izar. She's got a long dira. There's no izar from the bottom. So izar is something that starts from the bottom, that goes down, okay? But the dira is something that starts from the top and it goes down. So she's saying, Umm Salama, أتصلي المرأة, does the woman pray في درع in a درع وخمار ليس عليها إزار, and she doesn't have no إزار. قال the prophet, he said, إذا كان الدرع سابغا يغطي ظهور قدميها, no problem, as long as that long garment is covering her legs, يعني the top of her feet, sorry, is covering her feet. The top of her feet. Remember, the bottom is on the floor anyways, but it's covering the top of her feet. So her entire foot is covered. Some sisters, what they do is they have an abaya, okay? And the abaya is not that long, but they wear a little izar from the bottom underneath their abaya or their, they wear that to cover it. So that's what Umm Salam is asking. What about if I don't wear that? The Prophet said, no problem. You don't have to wear another izar at the bottom, but with the condition like it. Here, that يعني ظهور قدميك, the apparent part of your leg is covered. And Imam al-Khattabi, he said, وَفِي الْحَدِيثِ دَلِيلٌ عَلَى صِحَّةِ قَوْلِ مَنْ لَمْ يُجِزْ صَلَاتَهَا إِذَا انْكَشَفَ مِنْ بَدَنِهَا شَيْءٍ. This hadith is an evidence. An evidence for what? The view of those who say that the salah will not be sahih, will not be correct, if a part of a body of a person shows. Because what the Prophet here said, إِذَا كَانَ سَابِغًا يُغَطِّي ظُهُورَ قَدَمَيْهَا فَجَعَلَ, he made the Prophet ﷺ مِنْ شَرْطِ جَوَازِ صَلَاتِهَا, he made it أَلَّا يَظْهَرَ مِنْ أَعْضَائِهَا شَيْءٍ. He said this in his Ma'alim al-Sunan. So a woman needs to cover her feet. Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha, she mentioned, لما سئلت عما تصلي فيه المرأة من الثياب, when I was asked, what is it that a woman, the clothing that a woman prays in her prayer, قالت, she said, she was asked this question. يعني أم سلمة رضي الله تعالى عنها لما سئلت عما تصلي فيه المرأة من الثياب, she said, تصلي في الخمار. The woman used to cover her hair, خمار. The khimar, again, he has to cover her throat, her neck, her chest, everything. وَالدِّرْعَ سَابِغْ, the dir'a is also covering her legs. الَّذِي يُغَيِّبُ ظُهُورَ قَدَمَيْهَا. Abu Dawood narrated that. وَلِذَلِكَ الشَّيْخ نَاصِر رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, Shaykh Nasir رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ, Shaykh Al-Albani رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ, he commented on the athar of Aisha where she said, لَابُدَّ لِلْمَرْأَةِ مِنْ ثَلَاثَةِ أَثْوَابٍ تُصَلِّي فِيهِنَّ. Aisha said that the woman needs three clothing to pray her prayer. Aisha said this. She said, dir'un wa jilbabin wa khimarin. The woman needs a dir'a. She needs a khimar. And she also needs a jilbab. Ibn Sa'ad narrated this bi isnadin sahihin ala sharti muslimin. Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah, Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah, he says, mu'alliqan ala hadha al-athar. He said, تلبس قميصا سابغا ساترا للقدمين فإذا علمنا وتساهلنا فصلاتهن باطلة. يعني فإذا علمنا وتساهلنا فصلاتهن باطلة. يعني the woman would wear a garment that covers the entirety of her legs. Covers her legs. Okay. Sheikh Albani saying this. So she's covering her. She wears a long garment, it covers her legs. She also covers her hair. If the woman she knows this, and she takes it very lightly, and she's like, you know what? It is what it is. فَصَلَاتُهُنَّ بَاطِلَةٌ. The salah is batila. Read about what he said about in his kitab Jilbab, Al-Mar'ati al-Muslima. But what about batil al-qadamain? What is the batil al-qadamain? What does that mean? The bottom part of the feet, okay, does that also have to be covered? The woman's foot, the bottom part, which is called batilul qadamain, does that also have to be covered? Or is it just enough the top part is covered? Jumhurul ulama, they believe, ala annahu laysa bi'awra fi salah. It's not awra in the prayer. the bottom part. And what's the evidence for that? The mafhum of the hadith of Ummu Salama. إِذَا كَانَ الدِّرْعُ سَابِغًا يُغَطِّي ظُهُورَ قَدَمَيْهَا. The top part of the leg is what needs to be covered. That's why some sisters, mashallah, they take precaution. So what they do is they wear a long garment, and they wear an izar under their dira' that they're wearing, and they basically place it under their legs and they stand on it. So if it happens that it doesn't cover the bottom part, no problem. And some sisters, they just wear socks to cover it, but you have to cover your legs. Another mistake that I see a lot is hajrul amakini fil masjid. Oh, this comes for the brothers and for the sisters, which is holding places for yourself in the masjid. There's this, this is my spot. You put your stuff there. Maybe you're not there. You call your friend and say, listen, the masjid is going to get packed. I know it's going to get packed. Can you put your stuff there for me so I can pray in that spot? These are from the things, لا تجوز للمصلي في المسجد. To reserve yourself a spot in the masjid that's specific for you. Or you reserve a place for your sister or your mom. And then anyone who comes and sits there, you say, no, 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 you can't sit there. And your mom hasn't come or your sister hasn't come. And so guess what? The entire masjid turns out to be what? Reserved places. Everyone's got his reserved place for his family. And these people are at home. They haven't even left the house yet. Somebody's come to the masjid and guess what? The entire masjid is a reserved place. هذا مخالف لما أمر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم به من التبكير إلى المسجد. This goes against the command that the Prophet gave us, where if you want a spot in the masjid, you have to rush, you have to hurry. You don't want to rush. You want to be at home. You want to come late. And guess what? You want to get the front line. Brothers do this as well. The Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَوْ يَعْلَمُ النَّاسَ مَا فِي النِّدَاءِ وَالصَّفِّ الْأَوَّلِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَجِدُوا إِلَّا أَن يَسْتَهِمُوا عَلَيْهِ لَاسْتَهَمُوا. And Imam Muslim narrated this. If the brothers, this is referring to the brothers, if they knew what was in the nida, for the sisters as well, the adhan, as soon as it goes off, the reward that's in it, okay? وَالصَّفِّ الْأَوَّلِ. Remember, this is specific, because the sisters, is better for them to pray at home. This is referring to the brothers. If the brothers knew the reward in the adhan and the nida to do the adhan, or to the front row, to pray in the front row, if the brothers knew that, ثُمَّ لَمْ يَجِدُوا إِلَّا أَن يَسْتَهِبُوا عَلَيْهِ لَاسْتَهَبُوا. And there was no other way. Every brother's fighting to do the adhan. Everyone's come at the same time. The masjid doors, is as soon as it's open, everyone is in the front row. And there's a quarrel over it. If the people knew the reward for that, that's what would have happened every day. Every day you would have been people fighting over adhan. People would be fighting over who the front row, because they all came at the same time. Ha! And the only way to reconcile this conflict between them is what? أَن يَسْتَهِمُوا عَلَيْهِ لَاسْتَهَمُوا. مَا مَعْنَا أَن يَسْتَهِمُوا? It means أَن يَقْتَرَعُوا. أَمَا يَقْتَرِعُوا. It basically means to throw a قُرَح. A قُرَح is to throw a lot. But sisters, it's not permissible for you to reserve places for your loved ones. But if it happens, somebody came early, then they needed the toilet, and they went. If they come back straight away, that spot is theirs. Okay? مَنْ قَامَ مِنْ مَجْلِسِهِ ثُمَّ رَجَعَ إِلَيْهِ فَوَ أَحَقُّ بِهِ. Hadith Sahih Muslim. In Hadith Abi Huraira. If you went to the toilet and you came back, that's your spot. But what about if the person went and they took forever? They went home, slept, came back. This doesn't apply on them. Ibn Qudamah rahimahullah said in this hadith, مَنْ قَامَ مِنْ مَجْلِسِهِ ثُمَّ رَجَعَ إِلَيْهِ فَوَحَقُّ بِهِ. Ibn Qudamah in his Mughni, he says, إِذَا جَلَسَ فِي مَكَانٍ ثُمَّ بَدَتْ لَهُ حَاجَةٌ أَوْ احْتَاجَ إِلَى الْوُضُوءِ فَلَهُ الْخُرُوجِ. Then he said, فَإِذَا قَامَ مِنْ مَجْلِسِهِ ثُمَّ رَجَعَ إِلَيْهِ فَوَحَقُّ بِهِ. لِقَوْلِ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم, مَنْ قَامَ مِنْ مَجْلِسِهِ ثُمَّ رَجَعَ إِلَيْهِ فَوَحَقُّ بِهِ. If the person leaves and he takes a very, very long time, then people are not going to wait for you. The salah is starting now. Someone's going to take that spot from you. Another mistake that I see a lot is حِرْصُ بَعْضِهِنَّ عَلَى الْجُلُوسِ فِي الصُّفُوفِ الْأَخِيرَةِ. A lot of times, women will come to the women's section. And guess what? They will pray at the end of the line. And you know the men and the women are segregated. And the women have their own side of the masjid. So what some sisters would do is, they would pray at the back of the masjid. They would deliberately be at the back of the masjid, and they would not come to the front row of the women's side. Why do they do that? The reason is because they want to leave the masjid quickly. Okay? This is also something that should not be done. The sufuf should be done one and the after the other. Hadith Jabir ibn Samurah radiallahu anhu, he said, خرج علينا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال ألا تصفون كما تصف الملائكة عند ربها فقلنا يا رسول الله وكيف تصف الملائكة عند ربها قال he said يتمون الصف الأول ويتراصون في الصف رواه مسلم. The front row, the front line, everybody. أتم الصف المقدم ثم الذي يليه فما كان من نقص فليكن في الصف المؤخر. أبي داود narrated one Nasa'i. You have to complete the first line. And then sometimes you're finding the sister at the back. She doesn't want to come to the front row. And the front is so empty, only so that they can leave the masjid very quickly. And this is something that goes against the Sharia. Another mistake that I see a lot is bringing your daughters and your sons and your children to the masjid. And you know that the child is going to cry throughout the prayer. He's a newborn baby or he's a toddler. Or you haven't disciplined your child at home and taught them the importance of the masjid. You haven't done that. You're that type of parent where your child can do whatever he or she likes. That type of child that you've treated in that way, you should not be bringing him to the masjid and then he distracts the entire masjid. It is so loud that even the men's side can hear it. Okay? And the masjid is a place for the people to remember Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So this situation, for you to pray in your house is better for you. The Prophet, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith Abu Dawood narrated and at-Tirmidhi, min hadith Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, salatul mar'ah fi baytiha afdalu min salatiha fi hujratiha wa salatiha fi makhda'iha afdalu min salatiha fi baytiha. So stay inshallah ta'ala home. You got the reward anyways. The salah in your house is better than the salah even in your living room. Your inner chamber is better than even the living room that you pray in. Imagine that. And to pray in the house is even better than for you to pray in the masjid. So aslan, it was better for you to pray in the house. And now that you have a child who's going to cry and he's going to weep and he's going to run around in the masjid and he's going to cause the people who are praying not to be able to focus, then sister, do not bring your child to the masjid. But if you have a child, you've taught him, you've disciplined him, you've spoken to him, he listens to you, you can keep him next to you, then inshallah ta'ala, that might bring khair for the child and he might learn from the prayer and the salah and the importance of it. Number 10, another issue that occurs in the sisters section, and I'm focusing only on the sisters, but some of them, the brothers as well, as I mentioned, is wujud al-faragat al-kathira fi al-sufuf. وعدم تسويتها. This is a common problem that occurs from sisters' side that is always asked. Sisters leave gaps in the line and they don't straighten the lines. Al-Imam Bukhari and Muslim, they both narrated from Hadith Anas ibn Malik رضي الله تعالى عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال that the Prophet, he said, سووا صفوفكم فإن تسوية الصف من تمام الصلاة. Straighten the lines, for verily straightening the lines is من تمام الصلاة, is completing the prayer. In another wording, which is the wording of Bukhari, the Prophet said سووا صفوفكم فإن تسوية الصفوف من إقامة الصلاة. Establishing the prayer. Yeah. When you hear fulan, يعني إقامة الصلاة means he straightened the lines. Part of the iqamah to salah, establishing the prayer. Actually, the Prophet said to the companions, "Istawu, straighten the lines. وَلَا تَخْتَلِفُ, and do not, everyone is not straightened. فَتَخْتَلِفَ قُلُوبُكُمْ, your hearts will then become, يعني, against each other. That's why you're finding Muslims fighting each other. disputes and disagreements and conflict. It's because no straight in the lines. Abu Dawood also narrated من حديث عبد الله بن عمر من حديث عبد الله يعني عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال that the Prophet he said أقيموا الصفوف وحاذوا بين المناكب وسدوا الخلل ولينوا بأيدي إخوانكم ولا تدروا فرجات للشيطان ولا تذروا فرجات للشيطان ومن وصل صفا وصله الله ومن قطع صفا قطعه الله. The Prophet he said establish the lines and bring your legs and your shoulders together. سد الخلل, block those spaces, close it off. And what? ولينوا بأيد إخوانكم, get close to you, the hands of your brothers. ولا تذروا فرجات للشيطان, do not leave gaps for شيطان. Look what the Prophet then said, ومن وصل صفا وصله الله. Anyone who connects a line, Allah will connect you. ومن قطع صفا قطعه الله. And to straighten the lines, my brothers and sisters, will not be إلا بإلصاق الكعب بالكعب. Yes, the legs have to be touching each other like that. That's the way that تَسْوِيَةُ الصَّفُ لَكَ. Forget what this person said and that person said. We have the kalam of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look what Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said. He said, فَإِذَا كَانَ التَّقْوِيمُ الصَّفِّ وتعديله من تمامها وإقامتها يسأل بحيث لو خرجوا عن الاستواء والاعتداء بالكلية حتى يكون رأس هذا عند الصف الأسفل من هذا لم يكونوا مصطفين ولا كانوا يؤمرون بالإعادة وهم بذلك أولى من الذي صلى خلف الصف وحده فأمر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يعيد صلاته فكيف بتقويم أفعالها وتعديلها. انتهى كلامه. ابن الحافظ ابن حزم رحمه الله, he mentions in his muhalla, he says تسويه الصف اذا كان من اقامه الصلاه فهو فرض لان اقامه الصلاه فرض وما كان من الفرض فهو فرض. Number 11 is ترك اكمال الصف الاول فالاول. This happens very common, you're not completing the first line and the line before that and the line before that. People are praying in lines after and the first line hasn't been completed, or the second line hasn't been completed, or the third line hasn't been completed, and a new line is being created. And we mentioned the famous hadith, لَوْ يَعْلَمُ النَّاسُ مَا فِي النِّدَاءِ وَالصَّفِّ الْأَوَّلِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَجِدُوا إِلَّا أَنْ يَسْتَهِمُوا عَلَيْهِ لَاسْتَهَمُوا. مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. The first line, أَتِمُّوا صَفَّ الْأَوَّلِ فَالْأَوَّلِ. One first line and then the second line. This 12th problem that occurs from the sisters is sisters go by in front of another person. يعني go walking right in front of the person. مرور بعض النساء بين يدي المصليات. You're walking right in front of the person who's praying. أثناء تأديتهن للنوافل, while the person is doing a نافلة. Somebody's praying sunnah. You coming, and they're not praying with the imam, they're praying by themselves, you go and you walk right in front of them. Or sometimes they even pray an obligatory prayer that they missed, the sister will just go and walk in front of them. And Imam Muslim narrated in his Sahih. Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said that the Prophet said, يَقْطَعُ الصَّلَاةُ الْمَرْأَةُ وَالْحِمَارُ وَالْكَلْبُ وَبَقِيَ ذَلِكَ مِثْلُ مُؤْخِرَةِ الرَّحْلِ. Three things they break the prayer. From them is what? A woman. Break the prayer. Also another hadith, Abi Dharr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said that the Prophet said in hadith, Abi Dharr narrated it, and you can find it in Sahih Muslim. إِذَا قَامَ أَحَدُكُمْ يُصَلِّي فَإِنَّهُ يَسْتُرُهُ إِذَا كَانَ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ مِثْلُ آخِرَةِ الرَّحْلِ. آخِرَةِ الرَّحْلِ. فَإِذَا لَمْ يَكُنْ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ مِثْلُ آخِرَةِ الرَّحْلِ فَإِنَّهُ يَقْطَعُ صَلَاتَهُ الْحِمَارُ وَالْمَرْأَةُ وَالْكَلْبُ الْأَسْوَدِ. You need to know this point then, my sisters. If you want to pray, you should place a sutra in front of yourself, or pray towards a wall or something, so that your salah is not disconnected. And if a sister sees another sister praying, don't go in front of her. Okay? Don't. Wait for her to finish her prayer. Okay? Do not go in front of her. The Prophet, he said, لو يعلم المر بين يدي المصلي ماذا عليه لكان يقف أربعين خيرا له من أن يمر بين يديه. والله, if you knew, the Prophet, he said, if you knew that walking in front of somebody, okay, if you knew the sins that you're accumulating, it would have been more beloved to you to stand for 40. It would have been better for you to stand for 40 than to walk in front of that person. Bukhari and Muslim both narrated. So you would have chosen to stand in front of Allah for 40. Now Allah, the narration doesn't mention, is it 40 days? Or is it 40 years? Well, Allah. Okay. Number 13, which is some of the mistakes that happen. Some sisters use the masjid as a place to buy and sell their products. They see that all the Muslims are here. Okay, smart. Why don't I come and tell people about my business and what I'm doing? Okay. اتخاذ المسجد مكانا لبيع بعض حاجيات النساء. This is something that's prohibited. That's something what? That's prohibited. It's not allowed in our Sharia. For someone to sell and buy in the masjid. That masjid has a specific ahkam. And it has adab, mannerism, where you have to observe. So that the haiba and the hurma of the masjid remains in the people's hearts and minds. And from the things that are prohibited, that are not allowed, is to buy and sell in the masjid. Even though it's allowed outside the masjid. Because this is from the ta'zeemu sha'airillah, honoring the things of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and the symbols of Islam. ذَلِكَ وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّهَا مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. You're honoring the symbols of Islam. أما as Allah said in Surah Al-Hajj as well, in another place, ذَلِكَ وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ حُرُمَاتِ اللَّهِ فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ. The word شَعَائِر is جَمْعُ شَرِيعَةٍ شعيرة. The word شَعَائِر is جَمْعُ شَعِيرَةٍ. And it is every single thing. Qurtubi mentions this. هو كل شيء لله تعالى فيه أمر أشعر به وأعلم. That's what شعائر الله means. أعلام دينه لا سيما ما يتعلق بالمناسك. So the masjid. البيع والشراء in the masjid is not allowed. The Prophet, he said in Hadith al-Imam al-Tirmidhi narrated, إذا رأيتم من يبيع أو يبتاع في المسجد فقولوا لا أربح الله تجارتك. If you see somebody selling and buying in the masjid, he's buying and he's selling things to people in the masjid. When you see that person, make dua against them by saying, may Allah not make your trading and your business successful. One of the things that you're not allowed to do, also do in the masjid, is that you're not allowed to announce lost property in the masjid. No. The Prophet, he said, من سمع رجلا ينشد ضالة في المسجد فليقل لا ردها الله عليك. If you ever see somebody come to the masjid and say, oh people, I lost something in the masjid, say to them, may Allah never allow it to be returned to you. May Allah never return it to you. Actually, Buraida radiallahu anhu, he mentioned anna rajulan nashada fil masjid, that a man came to the masjid and he actually announced that he lost his camel. Okay, or he lost something. The Prophet then said, when he heard him, man da'a ila al-jabal al-ahmar. Who is that person calling for that red camel? The Prophet then said, la wajadta, may you never find it. إِنَّمَا بُنِيَتِ الْمَسَاجِدُ لِمَا بُنِيَتْ لَهُ. The masjid were built for what it was built for, meaning to worship Allah تبارك وتعالى. Amr ibn Shu'ayb narrated from عن أبيه عن جده رضي الله عنه قال, he said, نهى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الشراء والبيع في المسجد وأن تنشد فيه الشعائر وأن تنشد فيه الأشعار. That the Prophet prohibited صلى الله عليه وسلم what? He prohibited buying and selling in the masjid. And also for the masjid to be turned into a place where people, yani, they battle poetry and etc. The masjid wasn't built for that. The masjid was built for what reason? لذكر الله والصلاة والعلم والمذاكرة في الخير. That's what it was built for. Nawawi mentions that in Sharh of Sahih Muslim. Also, one of the common mistakes that men and women make, but you see a lot in the Haramain al-Sharifain, Mecca and Medina, is that somebody will take the mushaf in the prayer and they're following the imam in his recitation. وَهَذَا خَطَأٌ وَمُخَالِفٌ لِمَا أُمِرْنَا بِهِ مِنَ الْخُشُوعِ. This is wrong and it goes against what we were commanded in the prayer. We were commanded to what? To have khushu' in the prayer. As Shaykh Abdul Aziz ibn Baz, rahimahullah ta'ala, what did he say about this issue? He said, لا أعلم لهذا أصلا والأظهر أن يخشع ويطمئن ولا يأخذ مصحفا وليضع يمينه على شماله كما هي السنة. He says, يضع يده اليمنى على كفه اليسرى. And then he mentions how that should be done. And Sheikh, of course, believes that it should be placed on the chest. Sheikh Abdulaziz ibn Baz, rahimahullah ta'ala. And then he says, وَأَخْذُ الْمُصْحَفِ يَشْغَلُهُ عَنْ هَذِهِ السُّنَنِ. Remember, putting your hand on your chest and all of that. Can you do that if you're holding a mushaf? You're losing that opportunity. It busies you from other acts that you were told to do. ثُمَّ also, he says, قَدْ يَشْغَلُ قَلْبَهُ وَبَصَرَهُ. It also preoccupies your heart and your eyes. Your eyes should be looking somewhere else where it's told to look at. So your eyes now is focusing on that. في مراجعة الصفحات, turning over the pages. Sometimes you're even looking how many pages has he got left. How many verses has he read? You're looking at the color of the mushaf. Sometimes you might even become distracted with the mushaf over the recitation of the imam. And then he said, فَالَّذِي أَرَى أَنَّ تَرْكَ ذَلِكَ هُوَ السُّنَّةِ. To leave of this. وَيَسْتَمِعَ وَيُنْصِتَ. Be quiet, listen. وَلَا يَسْتَعْمِلَ الْمُصْحَفِ. And don't use a mushaf. And now it's even become worse because now people are using mobile phones. Hey, naam. So people are getting their phones out. And so now that they've got their phones out, guess what? Text messages are coming through and all that. And person is sometimes getting accidentally fingers hitting it and ajeeb. So no. If you've memorized the Qur'an, alhamdulillah. If you've not memorized the Qur'an, then that's a reminder for you that you should not be carrying a mushaf. Learn and memorize the Qur'an. Okay? Another mistake is الخطأ في طريقة رفع اليدين في تكبيرة الإحرام. Some people, they do a mistake when they're raising their hands in تكبيرة الإحرام. Some of our sisters, or a lot of the sisters, they do their تكبيرة الإحرام, رفع اليدين في تكبيرة الإحرام. They do it with their hands not facing this way. So they flip it this way. So a lot of sisters, what they do, Allahu Akbar. And their hands, palms, the palm of the hands are facing towards her face. وَهَذَا مُخَالِفٌ لِلسُّنَّةِ. First of all, the fingers have to be out. Don't bring them too out like that, and don't stick them two together like that. Make a little bit of space. Okay, a little bit of space. With your fingers from your hands. Do a little bit of space like that. And the batin, the inner part of your hand, this part, should be facing outwards towards the Qibla. That's the Prophet's prayer. And Imam Abu Dawood and Tirmidhi and Nasa'i and others mention it. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دخل في الصلاة رفع يديه مدا. Also, the hadith of Tirmidhi and Ibn Khuzaymah mentioned that. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا قام إلى الصلاة قال هكذا وأشار أبو عمر بيديه ولم يفرج بين أصابعه ولم يضمها. He didn't bring it together like this, and he didn't do like this. Make it. And also, Al-Jabir ibn Wa'il narrated from his father that he saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if he did takbiratul ihram, or iftatah as-salah, rafa'a yadayhi hatta takadu ibhamaha tuhadi shahmat udhunayhi. Again, close to your ears or your shoulders. Okay? Ibn al-Qayyim also speaks about in Zad al-Ma'ad, the ways, description of the Prophet ﷺ there as well. Another mistake that you find in sisters and brothers alike, but again, we're addressing the sisters, is kathratul harakati fi salah. Excessive movements. Scratching himself and moving in the salah too much. Some sisters, they move so much in the prayer. Min ghayri haja, when there is no need for it. And sometimes they even raise their eyes up, looking around. One of them was look at the sky, raising her eyes to the saqf and the roof. Because it goes back to what? Some of the characteristics that some of our dear sisters have, which is they want to know everything. They're nosy, they want to be, so they're looking at the roof, the masjid roof hasn't been built, where are they taking the donation money? You see that? فَتَجِدُ الْوَاحِدَ مِنْهُنَّ تَرْفَعُ بَصَرَهَا إِلَى السَّقْفِ. She's looking at the roof. She's looking at the nuqush. She's looking at the design. She's like, why are they choosing this poor design? Wallahi, I think I could do better. Yeah. Wallahi, etc. She's not even in a ibadah. She's designing the masjid. I think that table should have been put there, and etc. أو ربما التفات بالبصر يمنة ويسرى. Sometimes she wants to look at somebody else's child in the masjid who's running around. Like, what's that child doing in the masjid? Why doesn't that woman grab her child? She's looking left and she's looking right. وَهَذَا مُخَالِفٌ لِلْخُشُوعِ الْمَأْمُورِ بِهِ All of this goes against the khushu' that we were commanded to come with. As Allah said in the Qur'an, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ The success and prosperity is for the believers. Who? The ones who, when they're in their prayer, they're in a state of khushu'. So, it is in opposition to the sunnah and nabawiyyah, the sunnah of our beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when a person is what? Looking around. Okay? What is it that you need to do? خفض البصر. Look down with your eyes. Look at إلى موضع السجود, the place that you're doing your prostration. The narration mentioned Hakim, and Imam Hakim mentioned this in his Mustadrak and Bayhaqi, rahimahullah, in his Sunan. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا صلى طأطأ رأسه. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he would pray, he would put his head down. ورمى ببصره نحو الأرض. And he would, his eyes would directly be gazing at the ground of the earth. And an Imam al-Nawwi in the Sharh of the Muhaddab, al-Majmu'a, he says, فَأَجْمَعَ الْعُلَمَاءُ عَلَى اسْتِحْبَابِ الْخُشُوعِ وَالْخُضُوعِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ وَغَضِّ الْبَصَرِ عَمَّا يُلْهِي وَكَرَاهَةِ الْتِفَاتِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ وَتَقْرِيبِ نَظَرِهِ وَقَصْرِهِ عَلَى مَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ There you go. Ulama unanimous in agreement on this issue, that the khushu' khudu' in the prayer, lower your gaze in the things that are distracting you. كَرَاهَةِ الْتِفَاتِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ Looking around and dangerous. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she mentioned, Bukhari mentioned this in his Sahih, that our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, سألت, I asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, عَنِ الْتِفَاتِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ I asked him, looking around in the prayer. What did he say? He said, هُوَ اخْتِلَاسٌ يَخْتَلِسُهُ هُوَ اخْتِلَاسٌ يَخْتَلِسُهُ الشَّيْطَانُ مِنْ صَلَاةِ الْعَبْدِ It is the snatching that the shaitan snatches from the person's prayer. You're losing your prayer. The reward is being taken from you. The Prophet went as far as saying, is the hadith Sahih Muslim, the hadith is Jabir ibn Samurah, radiallahu anhu, the Prophet went as far as saying, لَيَنْتَهِيَنَّ أَقْوَامٌ يَرْفَعُونَ أَبْصَارَهُمْ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ أَوْ لَا تَرْجِعُوا إِلَيْهِمْ The Prophet, he said, لَيَنْتَهِيَنَّ أَقْوَامٌ A group of people will leave off. What would they leave off? يَرْفَعُونَ أَبْصَارَهُمْ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ Raising their eyes up to the sky when they are praying. أَوْ لَا تَرْجِعُوا إِلَيْهِمْ Or their eyesight will never return back to them. Another mistake that some people do, which is تَغْمِيضُ الْعَيْنَيْنِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ Some people, they close their eyes. That's it. He's closing his eyes. And I've seen a brother who said, I sleep if I go to close. He closes his eyes and he's snoring, standing up. I don't know how somebody can snore or sleep while standing up. But this is, again, coming from what? Why even close your eyes in the first place? If you're so light in sleeping, the mistake is, first of all, why did you close your eyes when you are in the salah? هذا خلاف السنة. ولذلك اتفق العلماء. The scholars are unanimously in agreement. على كراهة تغميض العينين في الصلاة لغير حاجة. That it's hot, يعني it's disliked. Okay? To close your eyes in the salah, if there's no need for it. If there's a need, meaning maybe you're in a place where يعني, there's distractions and there's things that's going to really take away your prayer, then, but that. يعني, صاحب الروض, يعني الروض المربع, he mentions, على كراهتي لأنه من فعل اليهود, because it's from the actions of the Jews. منار السبيل والكافي, they said, لأنه مظنة النوم, which is what I mentioned. It's what's going to lead you to sleeping. And Ibn al-Qayyim رحمه الله, he mentions, He says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ إِذَا كَانَ أَكْثَرَ خُشُوعًا بِتَفْتِيحِ الْعَيْنَيْنِ فَهُوَ أَوْلَى وَإِنْ كَانَ أَخْشَعَ لَهُ تَغْمِضَ الْعَيْنَيْنِ لِوُجُودِ مَا يَشْغَلُهُ عَلِ الصَّلَاةِ مِنْ تَزْوِيقٍ وَزَخْرَفَ Something like that I mentioned, the designs and the calligraphy. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يُكْرَهُ قَطْعًا And it's not disliked for that person to close their eyes. If there's like really distracting things that's going to prevent you from it, maybe in that situation, it's actually recommended maybe to even close your eyes, he says Ibn al-Qayyim, because it's more closer to إلى مقاصد الشرع وأصوله رحمه الله. He mentions this in his Zad al-Ma'ad. But generally speaking, no. Another mistake the grabbing of the hands in the prayer. This is another mistake that occurs. في قبض اليدين في الصلاة, grabbing the hands in the prayer. Some of the sisters, they do a mistake in the كَيْفِيَّةُ قَبْضِ الْأَيْدِ, the way that they grab. So for example, some sisters, what do they do? فَمِنْهُنَّ, some of them, مَنْ تَضَعُ يَدَهَا الْيُسْرَى فَوْقَ الْيُمْنَى, she places her left hand over her right hand. So it's wrong way around. So she takes her left hand and she places it over her right. That's a mistake. That's wrong. Some of them, now, وَمِنْهُنَّ مَنْ تَشَبَّعَ أَصَابِعَهَا, one of, she does, يعني, she puts her fingers inside each other like this. So the fingers are in. وَمِنْهُنَّ مَنْ تُنَزِّلُ يَدَيْهَا نَاحِيَةَ الْبَطْنِ, and some of them, she brings it down and it towards her stomach. And some of them don't even grab their hands. And all of that is what? كُلُّ هَذِي كَيْفِيَتْ مُخَالِفَ لِلسُّنَّةِ النَّبَوِيَّةِ. As for the wada, Imam al-Bukhari narrated in his Sahih that Sahal ibn Sa'd al-Sa'idi said, كان الناس يؤمرون أن يضع الرجل اليد اليمنى على ذراعه اليسرى في الصلاة. Bukhari narrated this in his Sahih. Hadith Sahal ibn Sa'd al-Sa'idi, that the people were commanded to place their right hand on the ذراع, the forearm of their left hand, في الصلاة. Okay, hadith ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, inna ma'ashara al-anbiya umirna bita'ajili fitrina, we prophets were commanded to hasten our fitr, يعني, the breaking of our fast, wa ta'khiri suhurina, and to delay our suhur, wa an nadha'a aymanana ala shama'ilina fi salati, and to place our right hand on our left hands. Tabarani narrated this in his Kabir, Sheikh Albani Sif Salati Nabi authenticated, Ibn Hibban, Diya al-Maqdisi bi isnadin sahih. The chain is authentic. Does that make sense? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was also mentioned, annahu marra bi rajulin wa huwa yusalli, he came by a man who was praying, wa qad wada'a yadahu al-yusra 'ala al-yumna, he placed his right hand, his left hand onto his right hand. فانتزعها, the Prophet opened it, and the Prophet ووضع اليمنى على اليسرى, and he placed his right on top of his left. Ahmad narrated this in Abu Dawud. As for where do you place it, there is a dispute, and I'm more inclined to the opinion that it is what? On the chest is more accurate. Placing it on the chest. This is based on the hadith of Wa'il ibn Hujr رضي الله عنه, where he said, صليت مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, I prayed behind the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, ووضع يده اليمنى على يده اليسرى على صدره. Ibn Khuzaymah narrated this in his Sahih. So this hadith, inshallah ta'ala, it's بإذن الله الكريم صحيح بشواهدي, according to Ibn Khuzaymah. Sheikh Al-Albani in his Sifa Salati An-Nabi, he says, وَوَضْعُهُمَا عَلَى الصَّدْرِ هُوَ الَّذِي ثَبَتَ فِي السُّنَّةِ وَخِلَافُ إِمَّا ضَعِيفٌ أَوْ لَا أَصْلَ لَهُ. And no doubt, even the chest, those narrations that Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah mentioned, all of them, فِيهِ مَقَال, there is questions to it. But I do say that placing on the chest, if we look at the weaknesses, if we put the weaknesses of at levels, it's the least weak narrations. And the most stronger narrations are closer to authenticity, are placing it on the chest. And so that is what my heart is content with, and that's what I do. And that's what I would. But if you don't, no problem wherever else that you put it, inshallah ta'ala. Another mistake that happens is, which is min al-akhta' al-sha'i'a, by the way, is that some sisters do not read Surah Al-Fatiha behind the Imam in the Salat Al-Jahriya. Again, there is a difference of opinion, but of course I'm going to consider it to be a mistake, because I'm of the opinion that you must read Surah Al-Fatiha. Whether the Imam recited it or not, it doesn't matter. The sawab and the correct opinion is أن تقرأها, you have to recite Surah Al-Fatiha behind the Imam, whether he recites it out loud or he doesn't. It doesn't matter. Okay? You cannot leave off قراءة الفاتحة في الجماعة. And you're not allowed to leave it whether you're praying by yourself. This is the qawl which is sahih min aqwali ahli al-ilm, which is wujub qira'at al-fatiha fi al-salah ala al-munfaridi wal-imami wal-ma'mumi fi al-salat al-jahriya wal-sirriya. And the evidence is because of the evidences which are clear and are specific. As the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in hadith in Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he say? La salata, there's no prayer, liman lam yaqra' bi fatihati al-kitabi, the one who doesn't recite Surah al-Fatiha. In another hadith, hadith Abi Huraira, which an Imam Muslim narrated in his Sahih, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, man salla salatan lam yaqra' fiha bi ummi al-Qur'an fahiyya khidajun. The Prophet said this 3 times. Ma ma'ana khidajun? Ghayru tamam. Your salah is incomplete. Then they asked Abu Hurairah, inna nakunu wara' al-imami. Inna nakunu wara' al-imami. We're sometimes behind the imam. Faqala, he then said, iqra' biha fi nafsik. He said, read it in yourself. And you don't read it loud, read it to yourself. And then he mentioned the famous hadith, فَإِنِّي سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولُ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نِصْفَيْنِ وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلْ. He mentioned that famous hadith, which he finds sahih, Muslim. And also it has been transmitted authentically from the Prophet ﷺ, أَنَّهُ كَانَ يَقْرَأُهَا فِي كُلِّ رَكْعَةٍ وَلَا يَتْرُكُهَا أَبَدًا. That the Prophet used to recite Surah Al-Fatiha in every rak'ah and he will never leave it. ولذلك حافظ بن حجر رحمه الله in Fathul Bari, he says, وَقَدْ ثَبَتَ الْإِذْنُ بِقِرَاءَةِ الْمَأْمُومِ الْفَاتِحَةَ فِي الْجَهْرِيَةِ بِغَيْرِ قَيْدٍ وَذَلِكَ فِي مَا أَخْرَجَهُ الْبُخَارِي فِي جُزْءِ الْقِرَاءَةِ. He says that it has been authentically transmitted. The permission that is permitted, it's allowed for the person behind the imam to recite Surah Al-Fatiha in the Salah, which is Zahriya, يعني Maghrib, Isha, and Fajr. Those three prayers which are known as Salawat Jahriya, where the imam recites loud, there's clear evidences, Ibn Hajar is mentioning, that have been transmitted from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. And he says, بِغَيْرِ قَيْد, without any restrictions to it. And then he mentioned that which Imam al-Bukhari narrated in his beautiful book, Juz al-Qira'ah, and al-Tirmidhi, and Ibn Hibban, and other than them narrated it, Hadith Ubadah, Ibn Samit, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, thaqulat alayhi al-Qira'atu fil fajri. The Prophet was praying, leading the people in the prayer, and the recitation became very heavy on our beloved messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya'ani, the Prophet it was very hard for him to recite. He was finding difficulties to read. And this was the Salat al-Fajr. فَلَمَّا فَرَغَ قَالَ. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam finished the prayer, he said, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَقْرَؤُونَ خَلْفَ إِمَامِكُمْ. When the prayer finished, the Prophet said to them, maybe you guys are reading with me. That's why the difficulty came from. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَقْرَؤُونَ خَلْفَ إِمَامِكُمْ. Maybe you guys are reciting behind your imam. قُلْنَا نَعَمْ. The Sahabas, they said, yes, O Messenger of Allah. Yes, we do. Look what then the Prophet said. He said, فَلَا تَفْعَلُوا إِلَّا بِفَاتِحَةِ الْكِتَابِ. Do not recite with your imam except Surah Al-Fatiha. فَإِنَّهُ لَا صَلَاةَ لِمَنْ لَمْ يَقْرَأْ بِهَا. There is no salah for the person who doesn't recite it. So these are evidences, my brothers and sisters, which are restricted and specific. As for the general evidences that my other counterpart might use, like, for example, the ayah, وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ إِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنْصِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. That when the Qur'an is recited, يعني فَاسْتَمِعُوا, listen to it, وَأَنْصِتُوا, be silent, لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ, so you may be forgiven. يعني, they say that this ayah is an evidence. If the imam is reciting the Qur'an, you're commanded in the verse, فَاسْتَمِعُوا, listen, وَأَنْصِتُوا, and be silent, لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. They say, this is our evidence. When the imam is actually reciting, you can't be reciting with him. You're told in the ayah to be quiet and to listen. We say this ayah is general. It's an ayah am. Okay? It's am, it's a general. So it encompasses Surah Al-Fatiha and other than Fatiha. And the hadith that we just mentioned right now, where the Prophet said, فَلَا تَفْعَلُوا إِلَّا بِفَاتِحَةِ الْكِتَابْنَا فَإِنَّوْ لَا صَلَاتِ لَمَنْ لَمْ يَقْرَأْ بِهَا, is a dalilun khas. It's a dalil which is khas. Okay? So what's the qa'idah? If the dalil is khas, and there is a am, which one do we give precedence to? Which one do we put forward? We take the evidences which are khas, and we apply the khas, and we take it out of that general ruling. So the rest still stands, meaning there's nothing else you can read behind the imam whilst he is reciting. You can't read with him any other surah, but Fatiha is an exception. ولذلك سعيد بن جبير العطاء المجاهد, they mention إن الآية في الخطبة, the ayah that I just read, وإذا قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له وأنصتوا لعلكم ترحمون. سعيد بن جبير العطاء المجاهد and others, they said إن الآية في الخطبة أمروا بالإنصات لخطبة الإمام يوم الجمعة. They said this is for the khutbah, by the way. They were commanded to be silent for the khutbah to يوم الجمعة. Okay. As for the hadith they might bring where the Prophet, he said, وَإِذَا قَرَأَ فَانْصِتُ, if the Imam recites, be quiet. This again is a general evidence. And the affairs of Surah Al-Fatiha is أَدِلَّ خَاصَةً. The qa'idah is فَتُقَدَّمُ عَلَى الْعَامِ, you put the khas before the am. هَذَا هُوَ الصَّحِيحُ مِنْ أَقْوَالِ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ. And this is being narrated from who? Umar ibn al-Khattab and Uthman ibn Affan and Ali ibn Abi Talib and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and Mu'adh ibn Jabal, and also the view of Al-Auza'i, and it is one of the views of Imam Al-Shafi'i. It's also a riwayah of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahullah. So this mas'ala, there are scholars who've actually written books on it alone. For example, Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, the one who authored the Sahih, he has a kitab that he's authored on this particular issue where he talks about wujub al-qira'ati khalf al-imam في السرية والجهرية. He talks about it. Bayhaqi also has it. So inshallah ta'ala, go to those books and read it بإذن الله الكريم, so you can understand the evidences and the discussion even more. Another mistake that some of us sisters fall into, and this is, by the way, it's not something only restricted to the sisters again, it's also something brothers fall into as well, like the sisters do, which is, more common in the sisters. And this is because they don't see the imam a lot. A lot of the masajid, the sisters can't see the imam. Okay? Majority of the masajid, the sisters are not able to see the imam. So the sisters fall into this mistake more than the brothers. But there's a lot of brothers who do fall into it. Which is الركوع بمجرد سماع أول صوت التكبير. Some sisters, the imam, as soon as the imam finishes the recitation, as soon as they hear a little bit of noise, they jump into the ruku' just by hearing the first noise of the takbir. When he says Allah, the person's already in. And the correct action to do this, and brothers do this, so that's why I'm saying it's not only for the sisters, but the reason why the sisters fall into this more is because a lot of them can't see the imam. So then that's another factor that contributes to them doing this even faster, is that you're not allowed to, brothers and sisters alike, to do ruku' with the imam. You're not allowed to. So if the imam is saying Allah and you're doing it, most likely you and the imam are doing it together. If you're going with him, yeah. And if you're acting upon it, as soon as you hear the first takbir, then that means you're doing the ruku' and with the imam. Sometimes some people are even doing it way before the imam, or before the imam. But the least we could say is that you're doing the ruku' with the imam. And what is the correct thing to do? You're not allowed to do ruku' until the imam's recitation of the takbir ends. لا تركع مع الإمام. You're not allowed to do ruku' with the imam until he finishes the ruku'. And how do you know that, sisters? The takbir finishes. Allahu Akbar. Then you go into it. And you don't do sujood with the imam until his voice ends, sisters. Because you're using the microphone. Brothers can see like him. The brothers have to, they can see the imam. So they, once he goes into ruku', then you go. The same thing, if he's going to sujood, you should not go into sujood with him, with the imam. You have to go into it once he's done it. You shouldn't make the taslim, okay, with the imam until his voice ends, sisters and brothers, until he finishes it. فَلَا يَجُوزُ, it is not permissible, أَن تُسَابِقَ الْإِمَامَ بِالْأَعْمَالِ, you can't compete with the imam in the actions that he's doing. You can't go before, no, first you can't beat him and go before him. وَلَا تُسَوِيهِ, you can't even be like him. And this is because of what is narrated in Sahihain, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Innama ju'ila al-imamu liyu'tamma bih." The imam was made to be followed. فَلَا تَخْتَلِفُوا عَلَيْهِ. Don't go against the imam. فَإِذَا كَبَّرَ فَكَبِّرُوا. You see that? If he makes the takbir, then make the takbir. وَإِذَا رَكَعَ فَارْكَعُوا. And if he does the ruku', do the ruku'. وَإِذَا قَالَ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَنَا فَقُولُوا رَبَّنَا وَلَكَ الْحَمْدُ. وَإِذَا سَجَدَ فَاسْجُدُوا. The hadith. Where are we getting that you have to wait for him to finish the action? We're getting it from the word that the Prophet used. فَإِذَا كَبَّرَ فَكَبِّرُوا. The fa here is called fa'u ta'qib. What does it mean, fa'u ta'qib? That fa, what does it mean? Fa'u ta'qib, what does it mean? It means أن تكون أعمال المأموم عقب الإمام. It means that your action is after the Imam's action. Your action of whatever he's doing, once he's completed that action, you then follow him after that. So be careful, sisters. You do not want to fall into a very dangerous prohibition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Another thing I see some sisters, and all this is years of me being imam of a masjid, knowing what the sisters complain about, them asking questions, emails. So these are things that are muntashir from their concerns. If a sister enters and the imam is raki', he's in a state of ruku', what does she do? فَإِنَّهَا تُكَبِّرُ تَكْبِيرَةَ الْإِحْرَامِ. The sister should do the takbirat al-ihram. Remember that a lot of people do this mistake. They come into the masjid, and what do? The imam is in the ruku', and they just start from the ruku'. So what do? You make the takbirat al-ihram first. Then you make a second takbirah for the ruku'. Be careful. You need to do your takbirat al-ihram. And then you do a second takbir, which is takbirat al-ruku'. Because the imam is in the ruku', right? You have to do another takbir for ruku' now. Unless you are scared that the imam might raise his head and there's only enough time for the takbiratul ihram, then inshallah ta'ala la ba's that you just use the takbiratul ihram and you go into the ruku'. Other than that, you should make the takbiratul ihram and then you should do the takbiratul thaniya for the ruku' that the imam is in. وهكذا. If you enter and the imam is sajid, what do you do? فَإِنَّهَا تُكَبِّرُ تَكْبِيرَةَ الْإِحْرَامِ. The sister makes the takbirat al-ihram. Then she makes the second takbirah for the sujood. Okay? The strongest opinion from the aqwal of Ahlul Ilm is that the takbirat al-intiqal. There's takbirat al-ihram and there's takbirat al-intiqal. Takbirat al-ihram is the one that starts the prayer. Okay? Takbirat al-intiqal is the takbir you do when you're moving from one position to another, like when you're going to ruku' and the one that you're going to sujood and the one you're going to go back to qiyam and all of that. These are called takbirat al-intiqal. The strongest opinion min aqwali ahli al-ilm is that the takbirat al-intiqal is wajibun tabtulu as-salatu bi-ta'ammudi tarkihi. That the takbirat al-intiqal is wajib. Okay. And the salah will be nullified if the person deliberately does it and leaves it off. So if you deliberately choose to takbiratul intiqal, to leave it, it's wajib. If the person leaves off deliberately, يعني تعمد, he قصد, leaving it, then that person is what? Salah is batil. What about في حال ترك سهوا? What about if he leaves off يعني سهوا, he forgot it? يجب سجود السهوا. Then it's obligatory for him to do سجود السهوا. This is madhhab al-Hanabila, and other than that, and Ibn Qudama rahimahullah mentions this, and he says al-mashhur 'inda Ahmad anna takbirat al-khafdi wal-raf'i wa tasbih al-ruku'i was-sujudi wa qawl saying the statement of sami'a Allahu liman hamida ya rabbana wa lakal hamd ya wa qawl rabbi ighfir li bayna sajdatayni wa tashahhud al-awwal wajib hu qawl Ishaq wa Dawud intahi sal. But if the person forgets in a jama'ah, you're in a salatul jama'ah, you forgot the takbiratul intiqal, or you were ignorant of it, then there is no obligation for you to come with sujood al-sahwi behind the imam. It's not wajib for you to come with sujood al-sahwi behind the imam. Why? Because the imam is dhamin. And inshallah we're going to talk about this issue, that you're guaranteed by the imam. Another mistake that happens from some sisters is, and it's also present with the brothers sometimes, is when you get up from the ruku', رَبَّنَا وَلَكَ الْحَمْدِ والشكر. The word والشكر, okay, some of the ulama, they mentioned the كلمة والشكر ليست, it's not واردة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. It's not being transmitted from the Prophet. ربنا ولك الحمد والشكر. So then it's better to leave it off. Okay, leave it off. What do you say in the prayer? إنما تقال الأذكار المشروعة. Say the أذكار which are مشروعة. وربنا ولك الحمد. And leave off extra things that some people are doing. Another mistake that I see a lot is كثير من النساء. A lot of sisters don't even know the مواضع رفع اليدين في الصلاة. A lot of sisters don't know places to raise their hands in the prayer. And that which is, so they raise their hands every takbir they hear. So some of them, that's what they do. Some of them, they don't even do no takbiratul, they don't raise their hands anywhere. They're against the idea of raf'ul yadayn. And this is a mistake. What is sahih is the mawadi'u raf'ul yadayn fi salah is four places. Number one is inda takbiratul ihram. The first one, Allahu Akbar. You raise your hands. Okay, that's raf'ul yadayn, number one. Inda ruku', so when you go to ruku', you make it again. That's two. When you get up from the ruku', وَعِنْدَ الرَّفْعِ مِنْهُ, that's the third. And the fourth and final one is وَعِنْدَ الْقِيَامِ مِنَ التَّشَهُدِ لِلْرَّكْعَةِ الثَّانِيَةِ. The first tashahhud that you do, and you're getting up, okay? The third rak'ah, whether it be Maghrib, whether it be Dhuhr, whether it be Isha, etc. Fajr, you won't. Fajr is the that's the يعني, يعني فجر, you're finished, it's over for you. Like in this one is التشهد للركعة الثالثة. It's the تشهد for the third rak'ah. You're going towards the third rak'ah. This, my brothers and sisters, you raise your hand. When you get up from the first تشهد and you get up, you raise your hands. Where do you raise your hands? This difference of opinion amongst the ulama, لا بأس, I don't see a problem in whether you do it while sitting or whether you do it while standing up, inshallah ta'ala. But that's a place also to do it, بإذن الله الكريم. And this is based on the hadith of Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim, and both narrated, okay, من حديث ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما, من حديث ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما, أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يرفع يديه حذو منكبيه. The Prophet, he used to raise his hands up to his shoulders. يعني حذوة means to the level of his shoulders. So it's just level it to your shoulders. إذا افتتح الصلاة, when he opens a prayer, الله أكبر تكبيرة الحرام, he would do that. وإذا كبر للركوع, again when he goes to ركوع, that's number two. وإذا رفع رأسه من الركوع, that number three. When he got from the ركوع, that's number three. رفعهما كذلك أيضا. وقال سمع الله لمن حمد ربنا ولك الحمد وكان لا يفعل ذلك في السجود. But he never used to do that in the sujood. The other hadith in Bukhari, hadith نافع, he mentioned أن ابن عمر كان إذا دخل في الصلاة كبر ورفع يديه وإذا ركع رفع يديه وإذا قال سمع الله لمن حمد رفع يديه وإذا قام من الركعتين رفع يديه ورفع ذلك ابن عمر إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. So he mentions here وإذا قام من الركعتين بعد التشهد, after the first two rak'ah, there's a tashahhud, right? رفع يديه, he would raise his hands, which is the fourth position. And look, ورفع ذلك ابن عمر إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. And Abdullah ibn Umar attributed this to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said that this is the Prophet's action. Also, from the أخطاء that happened في صفة الجلوس بين السجدتين والجلوس للتشهد. This is another mistake that happens in the mistakes, is the way that the sisters sit between the two sajda, and they sit for the tashahhud. And of course, this is also for the brothers as well. Majority of the sisters, they don't restrict themselves to that which has come from our beloved Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, min al-iftirashi wa-tawarruqi. The way that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to sit is al-iftirash wa-tawarruq. What are these words? I can explain it all day for you, but you will not maybe understand it. It's good to go online and look it up. But I'll explain it loosely. The word al-iftirash is that you put one leg, which is your right up, and the other leg, you sit on that leg. The leg is flat, the left leg, and your right leg, your foot is up, and your fingers are down like that. Your right rigil, your right foot is up, and you're sitting on your left leg. Your fingers are facing towards the qibla, okay? And you're sitting on it. This is called al-iftirash. Okay? And the Prophet, this is Sunnah Nabawiyyah, Hadith Sahih Muslim. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول في كل ركعتين التحية وكان يفرش رجله اليسرى وينصب اليمنى. That's the first thing you can do. We're talking about al-julus bayna sajdatayn, or the julus for the tashahhud. There's another sitting, which is at-tawarruk. Tawarruk is also sunnah thabita of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Bukhari narrated it. From who? أبي حميد السعيدي رضي الله عنه في صفة صلاة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. What is it? وإذا جلس في الركعة الأخيرة, when the Prophet sat for the last rak'ah, what did he do? قدم رجله اليسرى ونصب الأخرى وقعد على مقعدته. What does he do? You sit on the ground, you put your right leg up, and the same left leg is down, but this time your bottom is on the ground. And the tawarruk له صفتان ثابتتان. There's two ways that you can do it. The first one is أيفرش رجله اليسرى, okay, and the second one is أيفرش القدمين جميعا. All of that, I would advise you to look it up online and you'll see inshallah ta'ala. From the akhta is صفتُ اليد عند التشهد. Another mistake. Where do you put your hand when you're doing the tashahhud? In the salah. Okay, where do you place it? أغلب الأخوات, the majority of the sisters, they do not restrict themselves to the authentic, sahih narrations from our beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on placing the hand, where to place the hand in the tashahhud. Some sisters, what do? They open their fingers so wide and open, and they do not raise their fingers. And some sisters don't raise their finger except when they reach the shahada faqat. And some of them, she puts it on her palm, her hand on her palm. She puts her hand on her thigh and she raises her finger without grabbing the other fingers with her hand like this. And these are all narrations from our beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What has come to us from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, okay, I mean the sunnah al-nabawiyyah lil-musalli idha jalasa lil-tashahudi, is two. The first one is the hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma. كان صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا جلس في الصلاة وضع كفه اليمنى على فخذه اليمنى وقبض أصابعه كلها. He grabbed his entire fingers with his thumb. وأشار بإصبعه, and he will point his finger التي تلي الإبهام, ووضع كفه اليسرى على فخذه اليسرى. The second one is أن يقبض الخنصر. All he would grab is the خنصر. Which is the smallest finger, this one. ويحلق الإبهام والوسطى ويشير, and he points his hand like that. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Again, these are things I would say to you. Look it up online. Also, it's been transmitted authentically that the Prophet used to move his finger and he used to look at it. Zubair ibn Awam radiyallahu anhu, he said, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا قعد في الصلاة جعل قدمه اليسرى بين فخذه وساقه. وفرش قدمه اليمنى ووضع يده اليسرى على ركبته اليسرى ووضع يده اليمنى على فخذه اليمنى وأشار بإصبعه. That's Muslim. And the ziyada that's added to it is that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم ويحركها. Sheikh Al-Bani رحمه الله mentions he used to, in Sif Salat, you can find it, is that he used to move it. That's fine, inshallah ta'ala. Another mistake that I see a lot is if they enter the masjid and the mu'adhin is doing the adhan for the salah, فَالْأَفْضَلُ لَهَا أَلَّا تُبَادِرَ. It's better that she doesn't hasten and pray tahiyyatul masjid. And you came into the masjid, the imam is doing the adhan. It's not good that you hastily pay tahiyyatul masjid whilst the adhan is still going on. It's actually better to wait, okay? And you repeat after the mu'adhin what he says. Once he finishes the adhan, you then pray. Because what you attain here, my sister, is a lot of reward. You get the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as the authentic hadith mentioned, hadith Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As radiyallahu anhuma, annahu sami'a an-nabiy sallallahu alaihi wasallam yaqulu idha sami'tumul mu'adhdhina faqulu mithla ma yaqulu thumma sallu alayya fa innahu man salla alayya salatan sallallahu alayhi biha 10 thumma salullaha liya al-wasila fa innaha manzilatun fil jannah لا تبغي إلا لعبد من عباد الله وأرجو أن أكون أنا هو. The Prophet said, I hope to be what me. Look what then the Prophet said. فمن سأل لي الوسيلة, anyone who asks Allah's wasila, يعني asks a wasila for me, حلت له الشفاعة. Intercession is for you. And Imam Muslim narrated this. So if you hear the adhan, say, the muadhin, sorry, doing the adhan and saying, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, you say whatever he says. Yeah, and you say after him what he says. And then when you send salutation of the Prophet, guess what? Each salah that you send of the Prophet, you 10 will be sent unto you. And then you ask the wasila for the Prophet, because that's a position in Jannah. فَإِنَّهَا مَنْزِلَةٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. And the Prophet mentioned, لا تنبغي إلا لعبد من عباد الله. There's no slave that is befitting for except a righteous slave of Allah. And the Prophet said, وَأَرْجُوا أَنْ أَكُونَ أَنَا هُوَ. And I hope to be that person who is going to be given that position. And if you ask wasila for the Prophet, فَمَنْ سَأَلَ لِيَ الْوَسِيلَ حَلَّتْ لَهُ الشَّفَاعَةِ. Intercession is going to be for them. Okay. لكن if you enter إِلَّا إِذَا دَخَلَتْ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ يَوْمَ الْجُمْعَةِ. If you come in on a Friday, for example, and the muadhin is doing the adhan, and he's doing the second adhan, then pray 2 rak'ah, khafifa, tahiyyatul masjid, no problem then. And then sit down and listen to the khutbah. Because why? Why is it on Friday, the muadhin is doing the second adhan, okay? And you know the second adhan, right after it is what? The khutbah straight away, right? So why is it that when you come on Friday, and the imam is doing adhan, so the muadhin is doing the adhan, second adhan, why is it now better to pray whilst the adhan is going off? The reason is because, and you pray quickly, inshallah ta'ala, khafifataini, not quickly as in that you rush it, but you pray very light. The reason is because the maqsood al-aham, this is fiqh that you have to understand. What is more important now, the adhan or to start the khutbah and listen to the khutbah from the beginning? The important thing is sama', listening to the khutbah al-jum'ah. Okay, وهو واجب لمن حضر الجمعة. And it's actually obligatory on the person who comes to the khutbah al-jum'ah. Okay, so if the sister comes, it's now obligatory for her to listen now. It's obligatory for her to participate and be aware and listen and be engaged, inshallah ta'ala. Another second mistake that the sisters fall into is some of the sisters, they enter the masjid and they sit down without doing tahiyyatul masjid. هذا خطأ. It's a mistake. And it goes against the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, authentically transmitted from him. The scholars now dispute one another. Is it a must that the sister or the brother, when they come into the masjid, that they have to pray tahiyyatul masjid? Is it a must? There is a qawl. There is a view that says it's a must. And they rely heavily on the hadith in Sahihain. Min hadith Abi Qatada radiyallahu anhu qala qala al-Nabiyyu sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إذا دخل أحدكم المسجد فلا يجلس حتى يصلي ركعتين. If one of you enters the masjid, the Prophet said, do not sit down until you pray 2 rak'ah. جماعة من أهل العلم المحققين, they took the opinion that it's wajib تحية المسجد because of that hadith and many other hadith. Actually, they went as far as to say that if there's a lesson going on or there is a khutbatul jum'ah going on, it's not right for you to sit down unless you pray 2 rak'ah. Based on the hadith of Jabir radiallahu anhu, where he said, Ja'a Sulayk al-Ghatafani came, wa Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yakhtub. Sulayk al-Ghatafani came to the masjid and the Prophet was doing a khutbatul jum'ah. Faqala, The Prophet said, Ya Sulaik, Sulaik, Qum. Because Sulaik went and sat down. So the Prophet told him, stand up, Qum. Farka rak'ataini. Stand and pray two rak'ah. Watajawaz fihima. Bukhari and Muslim both narrated. So stand up and pray two rak'ah. This is, they say, look, the Prophet stopped the khutbatul Jum'ah, addressed Sulaik al-Ghatafari by telling him, stand up and pray two rak'ah. So they said, this is obligatory. Another narration, or another riwayah in Sahihain, mentions أنه صلى الله عليه وسلم أمر سليكا الغطفاني رضي الله عنهما رضي الله عنه. The Prophet commanded him عندما دخل المسجد أثناء خطبتي أن يصلي ركعتين خفيفتين. يعني the Prophet commanded him. It says أنه أمر سليكا. Also the hadith in Sahih Muslim من حديث أبي قتادة الحارث بن الربعي رضي الله عنه قال he said دخلت المسجد I entered the masjid ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم جالس بين ظهراني الناس قال فجلست فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما منعك أن تركع ركعتين قبل أن تجلس قلت يا رسول الله رأيتك جالسا والناس جلوس قال إذا دخل أحدكم المسجد فلا يجلس حتى يركع ركعتين. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to him, what happened was أبي قتادة الحارث بن الربعي رضي الله عنه he entered the masjid and he saw the Prophet ﷺ sitting with the people. فجلس, he sat down. The Prophet then asked him a question. He said, ما منعك أن تركع ركعتين قبل أن تجلس? What is it that stopped you praying two units before you sat down? He said, يا رسول الله رأيتك جالسا. I saw you sitting down. والناس جلوس. And the people were sitting with you. And they were all sitting. So I thought, يعني, since you're sitting, رسول الله, and the people are sitting, I thought I'd sit with you. The Prophet then said, إِذَا دَخَلَ أَحَدُكُمُ الْمَسْجِدِ If one of you enters the masjid, فَلَا يَجْلِسِ Do not sit down, حَتَّى يَرْكَعَ رَكْعَتَيْنِ So the scholars, they hold that these narrations show obligation. And it's a must for the man or the woman, if they enter the masjid, that they have to pray two units. My brothers and sisters, whatever view you hold, whether you see it obligatory or whether you see it recommended, the fact that the Prophet had encouraged all these companions to pray, it's something that should make us feel uncomfortable if we just come to the masjid, we sit down, unless it's a good reason. Unless there is a very good, valid reason. Other than that, do not make it an aada, wadaydana, that you enter the masjid and you don't pray two rak'ah sunnah. Especially if you see that the opinion, it is obligatory, it's a must, then la shaka, you're doing a sin by not praying. And if you see it to be highly recommended, then as well, the fact that the Prophet addressed it, the Prophet, you know, encouraged the noble companion, Abi Qatadat al-Harith ibn al-Rabi'i, Sulaik, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, Sulaik al-Ghatafani, shows that something that the Prophet is stopping the khutbatul Jum'ah for, something that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling a companion, what is it that stopped you from doing it? It should be something very important to us. And we should not even leave it off because we see it to be a sunnah. Another mistake that happens is if a sister enters the masjid. Again, remember we're talking about Ramadan and generally focusing on Ramadan. Even though some of the points that we're mentioning can be used for outside Ramadan. But the sister enters the masjid and she comes in and the Salat al-Isha has already been prayed. She was at home cooking and everything. She couldn't get in time for Isha. So she comes and they're in Salat al-Taraweeh. Okay, and she's missed Salatul Isha. A lot of sisters, what they do is, and also brothers do that as well, so this applies to both, is the person goes and they pray by themselves whilst the people are praying Taraweeh. The person goes and he prays alone by himself Salatul Isha. And then when he finishes the Isha, he comes and he prays Salatul Taraweeh with the people. That's not what you should do. What you should do is, you stand up and you pray Salatul Taraweeh. وَتُصَلِّ الْعِشَى You're praying Salatul Taraweeh and you're praying Salatul Isha. Taraweeh and Isha. And the Imam is going to be reciting. The two rak'ah that the Imam is praying for Salatul Taraweeh, you enter and you pray with him. So you're praying Taraweeh with him. But what's your intention? بنيتي فريضة العشاء. You have the intention of عشاء. That's مشروع, that's permissible. And there's no, because this is where the problem comes from. The اختلاف of the niyyah of the imam and the ma'moom being different is not a problem. The sunnah has shown the permissibility of that. And when the imam, after the 2 rak'ah, says the salams, okay, you stand up and you pray a 2 that's missing from you. So don't miss out in praying jama'ah. You got jama'ah to be praying with now. Okay? So when they're praying taraweeh, you can pray with them your salatul isha. Don't miss out that opportunity. Also, one of the common mistakes that if they pray the faridatul isha, sister, she prays the isha. Salatul isha, she prayed it. Straight away she stands, ba'da salam al-imam, as soon as the imam says assalamu alaikum, salamat, she stands up quickly so she can pray the sunnah of isha. My sister, and also brothers as well, come with the adhkar ma ba'da salah. There's adhkar that should be recited and read after the salah. Read that first. And that is by reading the 3 times istighfar, then the tahleel, then the tasbih, then the tahmeed, and then the tahleel, then the mu'awwidhatayn, then ikhlas, then ayatul kursi, then you can pray your sunnah ratiba. After you did all of that, stand up and then pray your sunnah ratiba. That's the action of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he commanded that sallallahu alayhi wasallam. In the hadith, in Sahih Muslim, it mentions, amarana bidhalika. The Prophet commanded that, he says, alla tusala salatun bi salatin. And tusala, salatun bi salatin means what? You don't connect one prayer with another prayer. Hatta tatakallama aw nakhruj. Or until you speak, or we leave. So you just prayed Isha, for example, and you straight away stood up and you connected it with another prayer. You shouldn't do that. You should disconnect it by doing adhkar. Separate one from the other. Are we all together, brothers? The wasl al-manhiyu anhu, the connecting which is prohibited, is waslu salat al-fariidah with what? Bi ukhra ba'da taslimi. With another prayer after the taslim. Before speaking or moving from your place. And the reason for that is tamiz ihdahuma ala al-ukhra. The idea is to separate one from the other. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah mentions, was sunnah, he says, an yafsala. The sunnah is what? An yafsala bayna al-fardi wa al-nafli fi al-jum'ati wa ghayriha. Kama thabata anhu fi al-sahihi anna sallallahu alayhi wa sallam annaha an tusala salatun bi salatin hatta yafsala baynahuma bi qiyamin aw kalamin. And he has a nice kalam, Shaykh al-Islam, in his Fatawa al-Kubra, the second volume, page 359, rahimahullahu ta'ala. The next mistake I see is that someone does a mistake. يعني إذا حصل منك خطأ, a mistake occurs from you. By leaving off some of the wajibat. By leaving off what? بترك بعض واجبات الصلاة. You leave off some of the wajib after the salah. You did a mistake in the salah by leaving off some of the wajibat. Like كنسيان التسبيح في الركوع أو السجود. You forgot, for example, the tasbih in the ruku' or the sujood. You did a mistake. So you left some wajibat in the salah. Or you left off takbiratul intiqal or other than that. But you're with the jama'ah. You're praying with behind an imam. Somebody would say, no, but Shaykh, I have to do sujood al-sahwi. No. فلا تسجدي للسهوي. بعد السلام, because you're praying after behind an imam. Remember, you're in a jama'ah. You did a mistake by yourself by leaving off, you forgot tasbih in ruku' or sujood, or you forgot takbiratul intiqal, saying it. The response to you, sister, is فلا تسجدي للسهوي بعد السلام مع الإمام. You're in a jama'ah. Don't do sujood al-sahwi after the imam, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in the hadith al-imamu, Abi Dawood narrated in his Sahih Sunan, Shaykh Albani rahimahullah authenticated in Sunan Abi Dawood and said in his, and he authenticated in Sahih Sunan Abi Dawood that on the authority of Abu Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet, he said, al-imamu dhaminun wal-mu'adhinu mu'tamanun. Allahumma arshid la'imma waghfir lil-mu'adhinina. Allahumma أرشد الأئمة واغفر للمؤذنين. This hadith, the Prophet, he said, الإمام ضامن. What does it mean, الإمام ضامن? What does it mean, ضامن? It means that the Imam is your guarantor. Many of the mistakes that occur from you, all of that is on him, inshallah ta'ala. يعني يتحمل سهو المأموم. All of your mistakes, he carries it for you. If you leave off يعني بعض السنن والواجبات, inshallah ta'ala, no problem. Okay? This is very important. فهذا ما تيسر. That was what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made easy for me to mention. والله أعلم بالصواب. فإن أصبت فمن الله تعالى وإن أخطأت فمن نفسي ومن الشيطان والله ورسوله بريئان منه والله الموفق وحده وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.